In 16 years at the University of Texas, Coach Cliff Gustafson has brought his teams to Omaha 12 times, and the key has often been pitching. It was again this year. Calvin Schiraldi, a five-hit shutout, as the Longhorns opened the 1983 College World Series with a 12-0 rout of James Madison. Gary Ward has brought his teams to Omaha three consecutive years as coach at Oklahoma State. His team was second in 1981. Offense the key for them. A fraternity row they call Jacket Slam-a-Row. They hit two home runs in a 3-1 opening round win over Stanford. It's showdown time in Omaha. ESPN, the Total Sports Network, presents another NCAA championship, the 1983 College World Series. Tonight's telecast is being brought to you by Budweiser Light. The best never comes easy. That's why there's nothing else like it. And by Timex, timekeeper to ESPN. Timex, we make technology beautiful. Tonight in the winner's bracket, it's game number 7 of the 83 College World Series. The Cowboys of Oklahoma State, Midwest Regional Champions, against the Longhorns of Texas, the Central Region Champions. Texas and Oklahoma State meeting for the third straight year in the College World Series. And a very pleasant welcome once again to Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, Nebraska, game 7 of the 1983 College World Series. I'm John Sanders, along with Irv Brown and Jim Price. Delighted to have you with us once again. We're down to the winners now. The losers, last night we eliminated two teams. James Madison is gone. Maine is gone. Whoever loses tonight will not be gone. They'll drop down into the losers bracket. The key, I think, Irv Brown, is to win, staying in the winners bracket in a double elimination tournament.
John, what it means is you can come back on Thursday well rested and throw your ace, and it does mean everything tonight. I'll tell you, we'll see two good ball clubs that will really get after each other. Both these guys can coach. They won't beat themselves.
And of course, as long as you stay in the winners bracket, you can pretty much control your own pitching staff, right?
Well, you can actually win this thing with 2.5 pitchers, and that's absolutely correct.
If you stay in the winner's bracket. Not everybody's able to do that, of course. Only one will go all the way to the championship. Let's show you exactly what has happened here in Omaha, Nebraska, since we started on Friday. In the first round, Texas shutting out James Madison 12-0. Then Oklahoma State defeating Stanford 3-1. So it's Oklahoma State and Texas here tonight. Then on Saturday, the other first round games, both 6-5 scores. Michigan defeating Maine. Alabama in 11 innings defeated Arizona State. Losers bracket games on Sunday. Stanford eliminating James Madison 3-1, and Arizona State shutting out and eliminating Maine 7-0. Tonight, the winners begin play. One game on the schedule, Oklahoma State, a record of 48-14. The Cowboys against the Longhorns of Texas, their record is 62-14. These are old rivals, Irv.
Hey, they really are. They get after each other. We've seen them play now the last 3 years, and it's something else. I like the rivalry. It's healthy. A lot of people think they don't like each other. That's not true. They just get after each other. They want to win. We'll see a dandy.
We'll be back to meet some of the individual players in tonight's game, and we'll have an interview with Gary Ward, the head coach at Oklahoma State. That and more coming up from Omaha. The 1983 College World Series continues. Another beautiful night at Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, Nebraska, as the 83 College World Series continues. Each of these teams has some outstanding individual players. Let's start with Oklahoma State, an All-American behind the plate for them. His name is Robbie Wine. He's the son of Bobby Wine, a major leaguer, and he's a good one.
Hey, he really is. You know, he had some knee surgery, but this guy's got it all. I really like his skills offensively and defensively. He was the 8th pick selected today by Houston, so he'll be a dandy tonight, I'm sure.
Here's a freshman, Pete Incaviglia.
Got the best hands in the tournament. He's fooling around right there, John, but this guy goes through that step stance the way you're supposed to.
And they hit home runs in bunches. 88 on the year. They had a couple in their opening game victory of 3-1. Texas, on the other hand, generally goes a little bit more with pitching. They don't hit as many home runs. They have some outstanding players like Mike Trent. Now, Mike Trent had 4 hits in the opening round game and scored 4 times.
And he could have scored a 5th time, but a ball that Brian Burroughs hit bounced over the fence, or else he'd have had that 5th run and a record. The guy is an excellent bunter, and he's got great speed.
And here's their starting pitcher coming up, Roger Clemens. A little bit of a question mark this year.
Well, you know, he was drafted 17th today by Boston. The guy's got good stuff, but he tends to overthrow once in a while. He's got to be very effective early. He is a streak pitcher. One time he won 9 in a row. He's got to go out and challenge very early.
And Jim Price is downstairs. Jim, are you ready?
I sure am. I have highly successful Oklahoma State coach Gary Ward. Gary, all the talking, we can throw that aside now. It's time to get it on. Yeah, 2 days is a long time to be off in a tournament situation. The apprehension kind of builds back. It gives everybody a chance to probably overanalyze themselves and the ballgame itself. It's a good feeling to be ready to play right now, and our kids are anxious to go out and perform.
Everybody healthy?
Yeah, very well.
What's it going to take to beat Texas?
Well, we like to score early. I know that's an overstated type axiom, but you got a ball club that runs real good at you. They play the hit-and-run bunting game. We'd like to take some of that away from them with some early runs on the board.
Okay, appreciate it. Good luck to you, Coach.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, hey, guys, well, I think we got a good one. Now back to you upstairs.
I think we do indeed have a good one. It is Texas and Oklahoma State coming up from Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, Nebraska. We'll be back with starting lineups for game number 7 of the 83 College World Series after this. The Cowboys of Oklahoma State, coached by Gary Ward, a record of 48-14. Leading off and playing center field tonight is Tim Knapp. He's 22 years old, a senior from Smithville, Oklahoma. In the number 2 spot is Scott Wade. Scott is the left fielder, 20 years old, a sophomore from Seabrook, Maryland. Batting third and playing right field is Glenn Edwards, 21 years old, a senior from Jackson, New Jersey. In the cleanup spot is the catcher, Robbie Wine, 20 years old, a junior from Norristown, Pennsylvania. Batting fifth and playing first base tonight, Joe Gorman, 23-year-old senior from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. The designated hitter is Pete Incaviglia. He will bat sixth. He's 19 years old, a freshman from Pebble Beach, California. In the number 7 spot is the second baseman, Steve O'Donnell, 21-year-old junior from Connellsville, Pennsylvania. Batting eighth is Chris Beck, the third baseman, 21 years old, a junior from Hollywood, California. Then it's Gary Green, the shortstop, 21 years old, a junior from Pittsburgh. He'll bat ninth. The pitcher is Eric Schmidt. Eric is 20 years old, a junior from Quartz Hill, California. And defensively for the Longhorns of Texas, Jose Tolentino is the first baseman, an outstanding fielder. There's Bill Bates, the second baseman for Texas. Mike Brumley is the shortstop. Mike was also drafted today. Brian Burroughs is the third baseman. Out in left field, it is Johnny Sutton, who was the star of the regional for Texas. In center field, Mike Trent, the young man who scored 4 runs in the 12-0 win by the Longhorns. Steve LeBay is the right fielder. Behind the plate for Texas, in game number 7 tonight, it is Jeff Heron. And out on the mound is Roger Clemens. His record is 12-5, 1 save and a 3.03 earned run average. Roger Clemens, one of the players kind of waiting around to see what was going to happen in the draft today, and that is on the minds of a lot of these players. 3 on each team drafted by the pros today. Irvin, we'll talk more about it as we go along, obviously.
John, you know, that's something that a lot of the college coaches here would love to see postponed a little bit. They would love to see the draft after the College World Series because they do feel, as you pointed out, that it is on their minds. But Clemens very definitely is right up there, going very early in the draft.
He has been drafted today, and of course, before the game, we asked him to tell us about the draft.
Well, I got a phone call this morning. I was drafted. I was a 19th player pick in the nation by the Boston Red Sox, and I was pretty happy about it, very excited. I'm just glad that that part of the, you know, aspect's over with. I'm not sure where I'll be going, you know, double-A or a single-A ball or anything like that, but the Boston Red Sox general manager called me and told me that he'd select me, and he was very happy, and it just made me feel, you know, wonderful.
Well, Roger Clemens is going to be part of the Boston Red Sox organization. Rosenblatt Stadium, a big ballpark. It's a triple-A ballpark, 343 down the lines, 370 in the alleys, and 420. It's a long way to dead center fielder if you got to hit it a ton to get it out of here. And with the wind, as it has been for the first 4 days of this championship, blowing basically in from left field across to right field, you have to really hit it a shot to get it out of this ballpark. Tim Knapp will lead it off. His average is a 326. He has a couple of home runs. One of them happened in game 1 for Oklahoma State. They call him Jack-a-slam-a-row, their home run fraternity. And we'll see how the Cowboys do against Roger Clemens tonight. We're underway in game number 7. It's been another beautiful day in Omaha. A little cool, as a matter of fact. They had a record low temperature last night of 39 degrees here in Omaha. The temperature now at 70. The wind coming in from the northwest. The humidity is very low. I think this is the coolest weather I've ever seen in Omaha for the College World Series.
John, you're right. Normally, they burn us out pretty good. And last night, it got a little chilly. You had to have your long undies on.
Knapp takes a called strike. First base coach is Wade Robertson. for the Cowboys of Oklahoma State. And the head coach is the man over at third, the man Jim Price talked to before the game, Jerry Ward.
He is the best third base coach I've ever seen in college baseball. A lot of guys get wound up in strategy and they forget the runners. Not Gary Ward. He's just outstanding.
Ball and a strike to the leadoff batter. Tim Knapp fouls it out of play. Umpires tonight, we're going to check them out in just a minute.
Timmy Knapp played for his father, John, in high school. You know, he's got the great ability to walk. A lot of people think that can be an accident. Not at Oklahoma State. They work at it. They hit in certain zones. In fact, for a while, Gary Ward wouldn't let you swing at a curveball unless it was two strikes. He's eased up a little bit, but this is one of the better guys in the country as far as drawing a walk. He had 11 in a row at one time last year.
1-2 to him. Struck him out. Tim Knapp is out on strikes. The umpiring crew, there are six altogether here for the College World Series. Hank Roundtree is behind the plate tonight. Dick Runchy is the first base umpire. The umpire is wearing white. They're the good guys here, I guess. Joe Driscoll is at second base. And over third is Dale Williams.
Dale Williams is also a National Football League official.
This is Scott Wade, the left fielder. He was 0-for-4. In the victory on Friday, 3-1 over Stanford by Oklahoma State. Average at 358. As a team, the Cowboys are batting 330.
Well, they've got the good hitting ability. And what's interesting, take a look at both clubs, John, is how many of these guys have been drafted. Now, for instance, Wade was drafted by Pittsburgh. He's got some power. I like his size. He's 6'3", 200 pounds. Seabrook High School in Duval, Maryland.
Fouls it back, 1-1. One out, nobody on here. We're in the top of the first inning. Third straight year that these two teams have met. And don't you know that the Cowboys of Oklahoma State have a little evening up to do for the last two losses.
Well, we've seen some dandies because they really get after each other. What's interesting about the intense young man we're taking a look at, you know, being drafted that high, John, got to believe it's going to help his confidence tonight.
Fouled out of play. Let's go downstairs to Jim Price. Well, we'll get that taken. Where's Jimmy?
Catchers, you got to watch out for them because they nap occasionally.
Oh, he sneaked out to get something to drink. It's two balls and two strikes on Scott Wade.
Scotty Wade was the MVP in the regional. Really improved his defense from what we saw a year ago.
Okay, Jim, you're back now with the cold drinks?
Yeah, I'm ready to go. Had a couple hot dogs, too. I heard you all talk in the pregame that these two teams do like each other. I got to disagree, you know. We heard this talk all week here that they get along fine. I disagree. I think they respect each other, and they're out to get each other.
Shows you what you know.
Foul. That one staggered the catcher, Jeff Heron. Really nailed him. Jim, you know what that's like, don't you?
Hey, that hurt over here where I'm sitting. They're underpaid.
Take another look. Once again, the catcher's got that protective pad hanging down from the mask, and that is such a good deal. The ball gets him in the shoulder. You just got to be tough. You know, we kid Jim Price a lot, John, but you take a look at the hands on that guy, and he's been around. He's broken every finger on the right hand, the meat hand.
Heron trying to shake it off. He's going to take a couple of tosses from his pitcher, Roger Clemens. Two balls, two strikes to count on Scott Wade. Going back to 1981, it was a 13-inning marathon between these two teams. Texas finally won it 15-8 in 13 innings. Then in 1982, the Longhorns really laid it on the Cowboys 9-1.
We saw that one, John. That was an interesting go.
He's still alive. Foul tip. Heron not able to hang on.
Got to tell you, John, this big guy is throwing pretty hard. We'll get the ray gun and find out exactly what. Look at the push-off he gets off that back foot. The classic form is all of Cliff Gustafson's pitchers have. They just throw very hard. They push hard. Clint Thomas does a great job with those pitches. We'll develop that a little later on.
Two strikeouts in a row for Roger Clemens.
The beauty of being able to change his speed a little bit because Clemens throwing hard came in with not the best downer you'll see, but by just taking a little off, he had Wade out in front. That is two strikeouts in a row. Cliff Gustafson, one of the bravest men I know. In 1981, during the regional, he was going down to see his mother after every ballgame because she was seriously ill. He got hit in the eye. Kirk Killingsworth, one of his relievers, accidentally hit him, and he spent a lot of time in the hospital. And his wife had a stroke, and through all that, he got his ball club through the regional and got him here to Omaha.
The third batter is Glenn Edwards, the right fielder, an even 400 for his batting average. He has 15 home runs. He is part of the Jack-a-Slam-a-Row that includes Scott Wade, Glenn Edwards, Robbie Wine, Joe Gorman, and Pete Incaviglia.
He was drafted by Cleveland. He's from Jackson, New Jersey. Played at Memorial High School. He's been struggling. He's been 0-for-8 in the last couple of ball games, but the guy is too good to stay that way.
Ball strike two. Right now, Clemens throwing hard, and he's throwing strikes to her.
John, we made the point at the beginning that, you know, he's got to be inspired going that high in the draft. He went ahead of Schiraldi. A lot of people didn't think that would happen. Clemens has great potential. He struggled a little bit early because of the bursitis in the shoulder, and now tonight, boy, he looks right in the early going.
He wastes one. One ball and two strikes with two outs. There's nobody on.
You know, you've been doing the College World Series for a long time and coming here. If we had the same format, this is the ball club that would be favored easily because they have so much depth in their pitching. The changes, though, gives everybody a chance now.
Struck out the side. 1-2-3. Roger Clemens sets him down in order. Now, let's check out the starting lineup for the Longhorns from the University of Texas. Here it is. For the Longhorns of Texas, a record of 62 wins and 14 defeats. Leading off and playing second base tonight is Bill Bates, 19-year-old freshman. He's from Houston, Texas. Bill Bates in the leadoff spot. Batting second, a switch hitter, Mike Brumley. The shortstop, he's 21 years old, a junior from Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. Batting third in the lineup is Doug Hodo, the designated hitter, 19-year-old freshman from San Antonio, Texas. And batting fourth is Jose Tolentino, the first baseman, 22 years old, a junior from Mexico City, Mexico. Number five batter is Jeff Heron, the catcher, 21-year-old senior from Cerritos, California. Batting sixth and playing right field tonight is Steve LeBay, 21 years old, a junior from Angleton, Texas. In the number seven spot is Johnny Sutton. He's a senior from Houston, Texas. He'll play left field. Batting eighth and playing center field tonight is Mike Trent, 22-year-old senior from Dallas, Texas. In the number nine spot is Brian Burroughs, the third baseman. He's 23, a senior from Gonzales, Texas. And the pitcher for Texas tonight is Roger Clemens. He's 20 years old, a junior from Houston, Texas. Now let's check out that defense.
Joe Gorman will be at first base. There's a look at the big guy. At second base, it's Randy Whistler. Whistler got the start over O'Donnell tonight. Shortstop is Gary Green, drafted by the Cardinals today. Over third is Chris Beck. In the outfield, it'll be Scott Wade, guy we saw go down on strikes and left. In center, another strikeout victim, that is Tim Knapp. Right fielder will be Glenn Edwards tonight. Here's maybe the best catcher in college baseball this year, Robbie Wine, drafted high today by Houston. On the mound, Eric Schmidt. John, this guy keeps the baseball down. He gets a lot of ground balls. He beat a lot of good ball clubs this year, including Nebraska, Oklahoma, Missouri, Oral Roberts, Wichita State, so he knows what's going on.
Well, you saw by the stats, he has not lost a game. We ask him what type of pitcher he is.
And pitcher, fastball over him, and a slider, and from underneath one, to a sidearm fastball base, and a sidearm changeup.
Sidearm fastball and a sidearm changeup.
That sidearm fastball of his is the one that gets the ground balls because he does break it into your hands if you're a right-hander. He gets a lot of ground balls. That first inning, John, Clemens only threw 16 pitches. If you're going to win, normally if you keep it at that number, you're going to get it done. To get up to 18, the statistics in the College World Series, you get beat.
Bill Bates is the leadoff batter. He was 2-for-4. Scored a run and drove one in the 12-0 Texas victory over James Madison in the opening round. He takes a call, strike one. At first base for the Longhorns is Bill Bethay. And there is Coach Gustafson on at third. Of course, Irv, that's been a change in recent years. The coaches used to stay in the dugout exclusively. Now they do come out. Some of them, it's optional now.
Well, it's interesting because a lot of guys don't think they do a good job. Pointed out about Ward, he stays so alert. A lot of guys are better off having a good man. John, you've watched a lot of ball players with Pittsburgh and everything, and this guy keeps it down, and that's the key to baseball. If you keep it down, let's take a look at the style here. Bates overstrides just a little bit. That means he's vulnerable to the curveball.
The shortstop, Gary Green, cannot make the play. The ball was hit in the hole. I'm not sure that Green could have thrown him out even if he had come up with the ball. He had to go to his right, backhand the ball, and was unable to come up with it.
All right, here's little Bates, and he's just a freshman. He's tough, and he runs good from that left side. Gary Green, who gets to a lot of balls, he's very fluid. Pivots, crossover, he's going to have to glove because he can't swing and get in front. So if he makes the play, he's got to throw off that back foot at a 90-degree angle. Base hit for Billy Bates.
That'll bring up Mike Brumley, the shortstop, a 283 average on the year, 1-for-4. 3 RBIs in the College World Series, 1983. Texas with a runner on board to start out.
One that got away from Oklahoma, John, because he is from Broken Arrow. Father played for the Dodgers. Mike was a catcher. They call this guy Pup. He also was drafted today. It's going to be interesting to see if they keep him in the infield or move him to the outfield.
Ground ball to the left side. Shortstop makes the play, has only one play. It's the first, and it's not in time. Well, so far, 2 ground balls to the infield, both hit in exactly the right spot.
Eric Schmidt has done his job. It's unfortunate for him, or if you're an Oklahoma State fan, because he does get you to get a ground ball. But both baseballs have eyes. Here it is. Brumley runs well, like a deer. Of course, from the left side, you got that two-step advantage. And Gary Green, who was drafted today by the Cardinals, has a good, strong throw. But they're in trouble now with Doug Hodo coming to the dish.
Gary Ward comes out. Moves around a little bit. Keep in mind that he does not handle the pitching at all.
No, he doesn't. Tom Holliday has got it all for him. Just interesting because Cliff Gustafson plays as much by the book as anybody I know, but he believes in Hodo. With a man on first and second, normally you're going to advance the runners in college baseball, but this freshman has been tearing the cover off the ball. He is a gap hitter. Now he's going to bunt.
Pulls back, takes strike, throw to second. The runner is caught up, and he's out.
That's a reason why Robbie Wine is considered the best catcher in college baseball. Keep in mind, this kid, his daddy incidentally, is here tonight, and we hope Jim Price will be able to interview him. This guy is coming off knee surgery, and wait till he gets healed up, you really see something.
I was not sure, Irv, if the third baseman could get back to the bag in time to cover up. Once they had the runner picked off, he headed for third, and the third baseman, Chris Beck, was able to get back, make the tag, so says the third base umpire, Dale Williams. We'll take another look at it.
Bates thinks that the tag is high. We'll take a look. Notice the throw by the second baseman. The tag does look high, but Dale Williams is right there. He makes a call. One of the interesting things, Whistler does not horn the runner. He throws it on the inside of the diamond, something a young infielder looking in ought to remember. Never throw it through his back. You throw it on the heart of the diamond where you got the ball.
Call strike to Hodo. The count on him is 2-2. Now a runner at first, Brumley, for the Longhorns of Coach Cliff Gustafson. One out in the inning. It's a big out. You get that guy off second base, sir.
Really is, and that's what Wine likes to do. Of course, now they've got the double play in order, and they're excellent up the middle.
Ground ball to third base. They'll try to turn it around the horn. Second for one. On to first. They get the double play. 2 hits but no runs in the inning for Oklahoma State. Oklahoma State getting out of the inning. Texas unable to score. We're scoreless after one. It's Robbie Wine, Joe Gorman, and Pete Incaviglia coming up. We're going to the second inning, the bottom half of the first inning. Irv, you called it perfectly. They have an excellent defense out there, and they turned the double play.
All right, here's a takeout slide as Brumley comes in hard. Remember, he's got the great speed, but look at the pivot by Whistler. There's a little wheelbarrow. A lot of times you'll go out there and jump over some kind of a barrel to teach your infielder, in this case Whistler, how to get out of the way of those spikes. He uses the back of the bag effectively. I'll tell you, it's amazing what's happened in college baseball, John. I know you get to see the pros a lot, but they just execute it as well as you like. The story on Schmidt in that first inning, he threw 10 pitches. Now, that's very, very good. Clemens threw 16 in his outing.
And our thanks to the official scorer, Lou Spry, for feeding us a lot of the information. Rob Wine's batting average is .283. He has 13 home runs, 36 in his career. He's the all-time leader at Oklahoma State. But anybody who follows Cowboy baseball knows that is not going to last very long.
No, not with a guy coming up in just a little bit in his first inning. But Wine is just exceptional. I just think his skills are incredible. Forget the .283 batting average. He has had a problem with that knee. He throws the barrel of the bat. He'll get that hard pivot. When you're doing that with a bad knee, it's very, very difficult to do what you want to do. Right now, this guy is doing what he wants to do, John. He's in control.
No balls and two strikes on him. Nobody out. Clemens has struck out four in a row. And Rogers making it look easy right now.
I'll tell you, that's not bad because he's been getting a little bad-mouthed. A lot of folks have wondered what has happened to Roger Clemens. We'll take a look at that high riding fastball. Here's the hard kick. Watch the ball move into Wine's hands. And in any way, anybody's going to hit that pitch because the barrel is out in front, and he comes right on the hands. If it was a wood bat, you make contact, it saws it off.
So Clemens has struck out four straight. Here's Joe Gorman, the first baseman. He has seven home runs to his credit, 51 runs batted in. He was 0 for 4. In the opening victory over Stanford, a 3-1 score for the Cowboys of Oklahoma State.
I guess he owes his mother a great deal. Didn't realize he had another year of eligibility because he bounced around, got a little disenchanted at Oklahoma State. Playing behind Tabor, he goes to Oklahoma City, then to Oak City, to the junior college.
Called strike to him. It's 1-1. Jim?
Hey, guys up there, I got a quick comment about these pitchers. They're both throwing very well, but as you see right now, Roger Clemens is pitching out of the shadow. It goes into the sun, and then the hitter's in the shadow again. I have a hard time picking the ball up where I'm at right here. Difficult for the hitters.
It's an excellent point, Jim, because this is a tough time a night, John, to get something going with that bat. We were talking about Gorman, though. He went to Oklahoma City and then to a junior college, and his mother happened to give him a phone call and say, you've got one more year of eligibility. And boy, what a big plus for Oklahoma State.
He had gone back to Oklahoma State just to go to school. Called him out on strike. Well, I tell you, Roger Clemens is pumped up right now. Five strikeouts in a row.
Everything 49. Is thrown, is moving, and, you know, Jimmy is down there and watching. He made a great point about the light to dark, but looks like the ball is moving as soon as it leaves his hand, and that's the key. We'll find out how fast he's thrown on the ray gun in a little while. But here's a look as Gorman, no match this time. That's five straight for Roger Clemens, the right-hander out of Houston Springs. He spent a year at San Jacinto Junior College.
And here's a freshman, Peter Incaviglia. 380 is batting average. Look at those numbers, 22 home runs.
John, I'll tell you what the people at home ought to watch. Watch this guy's hands. They're amazing. They're the best I've seen in the tournament.
And he's very, very strong. Good strength. He's going to break those home runs, the home run record that is currently held by Robbie Wine. He has a home run in this series. Only two people have been able to hit it out to left field. He's one of them. We talked about his strength, and we asked him how he developed it. Here's what he had to say.
I lift a lot of weights during the offseason in football. I played football, and I lifted weights during basketball season to strengthen my forearm, straighten my wrist. And, you know, I've done it ever since I was in junior high. And, you know, now it's paying off. You know, I still do. You know, I play during now. And then, you know, as soon as it's done, I'll go back to lifting weights again and get real strong.
I'll tell you, if he ever connects with a fastball from Clemens, it's going to go forever.
John, he reminds me of Harmon Killebrew with his step stance. He's into his stance. And then when the hands go back before coming forward, he's the best I've seen in this tournament. That's where he gets that explosion. He's got good size, he's got the legs, the big behind, but watch the hands explode.
But at this point in time, Roger Clemens is unhittable. He throws the slider and he hits the corner. He throws the fastball, pushes you back. You know, he's doing everything right.
John, ain't anybody gonna hit this pitch. Watch on the black part of the plate. And that is
that's
just
nasty too, you know.
Jeff Heron moves out. I'll tell you what, Clemens, who's been drafted three times by the Blue Jays and the Mets, and then today he's very excited by the Red Sox. He's got it all going his way. Oh!
Well, that's six strikeouts in a row. Clemens has set down the first six batters he has faced, all on strikes. Coming up for the Longhorns, Tolentino, Heron, and LeBay were scoreless here in Omaha. I tell you what, the Texas players love what they're seeing. Watch the reaction on the called third strike that ends the inning. Looks like they're coming out to celebrate a victory, Irv.
Well, John, this is one of the things I still love about college baseball. We had Tom Boswell here last year, covers the pros in the Washington Post. Maybe as good a writer as there is in the country. And he pointed that out. It's just how great these people are here and the enthusiasm and everything.
Well, we don't have the official attendance yet. We'll get it later. I'd say this is the biggest crowd we've had so far in the first 3 days of this tournament. It appears to be the Rosenblatt Stadium. It's almost full to capacity, and they are on a very close to a record-setting type pace. 2 years ago, 120,000 fans came to Omaha, to Rosenblatt Stadium, to watch the World Series. So there's a lot of people in here.
Talk about a record-setting pace. Clemens has only thrown 28 pitches, an average of 14, and of course, he has struck out everybody he has faced.
He might throw fewer pitches if they'd occasionally hit one, right?
Yeah.
Here's Jose Tolentino. 353 is his batting average. 14,000 plus on hand. We'll get the official numbers later. That is the estimate. So that is the biggest crowd that we've had so far this week here in Omaha. Tolentino, even though his team won 12-0 in the opening round, he wore the collar. 0-6. And here's a man that owns almost every Longhorn offensive record. He had a rough start to the College World Series.
Yeah, he really did. And, you know, this is the guy out of Mexico City. He's 6'1", 196. All-American from Seminole Junior College. And Cliff Gustafson goes into Seminole and does a good job recruiting. Tell you one thing, John. He's got seven in his family, so I'm sure he knows how to eat fast. Eat fast and eat a lot, just like the training table.
Two balls, one strike to count on him. Looking for his first hit in College World Series play for this season. Slaps it foul. Past his coach. There's Gary Ward looking on. Not much need of coaching third when everybody strikes out.
Well, I'll tell you what, it's not very tough on those infielders. Not hard to throw it around after a strikeout. You don't make any errors. You know, talking about this big guy at the dish, Tolentino, he was a legend in junior college ball as he hits one.
Bounces it up the middle, and it gets through for a base hit. Hit number three for the Longhorns of Texas.
They continue to find those gaps, John.
Jeff
mentioned that he's a little bit of a legend. He holds a national JUCO record for base hits and RBIs. The biggest hole in baseball is up the middle. We saw Magadan from Alabama just wear everybody out, just going up the middle. For the young hitter looking in, you try and hit it right back at the pitcher, good things happen, just like it did to Tolentino.
Jeff Heron will be the batter. These two teams are playing for the seventh time in the College World Series. Texas leads that 4-2. On the inside corner, a called strike. Matter of fact, Texas has been here more times than anyone else, 23 in all. Cowboys are third in appearances. This is their 13th trip to the College World Series. Runner at first with nobody out. Called strike two.
Schmidt's the kind of guy you want if you're a Gary Green and Randy Whistler, and they're talking to each other. They always get together up the middle. Who's going to cover on a throw from the pitcher, Schmidt? They look for a ground ball here, and if history repeats, that's all we've seen thus far is four ground balls. Let's see if he gets another one.
Chops it foul. It caught a piece of Robbie Wine, I believe, behind the plate. Robbie will walk it off. Be all right. Boy, what a great catching prospect he is.
He really is, John. That close-up there, I wish he'd wear that pad that hangs down that Steve Yeager got everybody involved with to protect the throat. I think it should be mandatory.
The runner at first is Tolentino. Got his first base hit of the College World Series. There's a line drive into center field. Tolentino around second. He will stop. Back-to-back singles here in the second inning. That's how the first inning started off, with two infield hits. So the Longhorns now have four singles.
Well, that's the solidest contact we've had. We can't say got good wood on him because nobody uses wood anymore. But Heron really slams the baseball in this situation. Been all ground ball. They've been moving and wearing Gary Green out. Gary Green was drafted by the Cardinals today, and the first thing he asked, how long is Ozzie going to play?
You wouldn't want to play behind him for long, would you?
Cardinals said Ozzie's only got a two-year contract.
Right. Here's Steve LeBay, the right fielder.
Let's see if they handle a bunt situation now. Cheating in at third is Beck. Gus should put it down here.
He does. For the first base side, the pitcher will field it and go to the second baseman. The sacrifice is in order. Score 2-4. You notice how the first baseman kind of peeled off and let the pitcher make the play.
It was executed perfectly by both sides, John. And let's take another look at it, because you point out something that's very true. Here's the good bunt by LeBay doing his job. But this would be a right-handed throwing first baseman. Be tough. Instead, an easy play for Schmidt. So the coordination is good. Schmidt called the play, and give credit to LeBay. This is a lost art. Most people don't bunt well with aluminum bats. All you do is catch the ball. You trigger finger, like when we used to play guns as little kids. You catch the ball, but with the aluminum bat, the ball sometimes is bunted too hard.
Johnny Sutton now with runners in scoring position for the Longhorns. I'll tell you where bunting is definitely a lost art these days, and that's in the major leagues.
Well, because everybody's looking for the big money and you don't get it if you bunt the ball, it's unfortunate. Now, John, in this situation, the infield's half and half. Gus is capable of squeezing with a guy like Trent. He can Sutton, I beg your pardon, he can't bunt the ball. They'll hold him on with Schmidt.
Runners at second and third, one out. The Longhorns trying to take the lead. Inside for the batter. The other thing that you have to think about as far as the two leagues are concerned, the major leagues, and you get back to the bunting, if you're a pitcher in the National League, you have to know how to bunt. The colleges use the DH rule, and the American League uses the DH rule, so I'm sure that these pitchers don't get to work on the art of bunting. You come into the National League, you have to know how to bunt.
It's a good point. The DH rule came in the last couple years I was coaching at the University of Colorado, and it really does make a difference. I just think, I'm not sure that you work hard enough at it. I know that the college coaches here do. I didn't spend enough time on it, but I don't know how much they work on it in the pros, John. And, you know, with a wood bat, it's so much easier to drop the ball.
That's true, but they normally come out, they'll take the mandatory one or two bunts, and that's it. Everybody wants to let it rip.
And when they take those one or two bunts, there really is a lack of intensity. You don't do that with Gustafson or Ward. You're going to sit down.
That's right.
Watch them in BP. We'll talk to Jim Price there, one of the great bunters who didn't like to bunt in the world.
Two balls and one strike with one out. Sutton trying to give the Longhorns the lead. Ground ball to the right side. That will score the run. He is out at first, but Texas leads it 1-0.
So Gary Ward trades him a run for an out here early in the contest. It's good strategy. Credit Sutton with an RBI.
He did his job. He knew that if he could hit the ball on the ground to the right side, he'd get the run home. Also moving up 90 feet is Jeff Heron, who's over at third. 1-0. Texas out on top, and this is typical Longhorn baseball.
It really is. That's the way Cliff has been playing it for years. He's just as sound as anything you want to see. Even though they're two out, Trent is very capable coming to this, John, of dropping that surprise drag bunt. There's a look at the veteran Gustafson. Doesn't have a whole lot to say. Neither he nor Gary Ward do, but they let their actions speak. And you won't talk to anybody, whether it's in Omaha, Nebraska, or in the collegiate circles, that don't feel that these two guys can coach.
You're exactly right. Mike Trent, 300 is his average. He had four hits in the game and scored four runs. Three of those hits were bunts, so he does love to bunt.
Beck has got to be alert now. He's very deep at third. And Gustafson is taking a look at him right now. Don't be surprised if he drops it. He can run like a deer. He and Brumley probably have as good a speed. There's a look at the third sacker back. Notice they lead off in foul territory, so if a foul ball hits them, they're not out.
One ball, one strike with two outs. A run in here for the Longhorns in the bottom half of the second inning. They've taken the lead in Omaha. Game number seven. The winner plays again at 7 o'clock on Thursday night. At Central Time in Omaha. The loser comes back on Wednesday night. Center field. On the move is Knapp. Running, runs it down. Beautiful play by Tim Knapp. He catches up with it. A great play by the center fielder Knapp ends the inning. But the Longhorns of Texas come up with a run to take the lead. It could have been more, but Knapp made a beautiful play.
Look at this. You turn and you run to a spot. In this case, Knapp watches the ball all the way, has to extend to make the catch. We've had some great plays in this tournament. That's as good as we've seen, John.
It is 1-0. Texas takes the lead over Oklahoma State. Bottom third of the order coming up for the Cowboys. As good a play as you will ever see. Ends the bottom of the second inning. Texas scoring a run. Look at this.
Crack of the bat. He's off. And Knapp made just an outstanding play. Rolls around the ground, shows the umpire, and that's so important to show the umpire, Dick Runchie. Look at the camera work here by Dave Goldman on the left side. This is just a great catch. Once again, holds the ball up because a lot of times an umpire can't see. Look at the reaction, unfortunately, by Trent. We can't read lips, which is nice.
Hit it as hard as he possibly could and has nothing to show for it. He better go back to the bunting again.
Yes. Schmidt used 27 pitches through two innings.
Gary Green, 309 is batting average. The shortstop, a draft selection today. The ball and a strike to him. He was drafted in the second round by the St. Louis Cardinals.
This guy is really fluid, John. Watched him now for 3 years. He's got a good arm. He'll pivot and cross over as well as anybody in the College World Series. And he doesn't have to dive for a lot of baseball because he is so fluid.
One ball and one strike to Gary Green. Fouls it back and out of play. Major League Baseball has been a part of his life for a long time. Has that been an advantage for him?
Well, I think it has. You know, I thought I played for the Pirates for a few years, you know, and now when I go back home in the summer, I'm able to work out with them, you know, and I think that helps me out, you know, and it definitely is an advantage for me.
Well, the team that you do, the Pirates, Fred Green, and of course he played with Jim Price.
Third baseman has a long throw, and he throws it away. That was a tough play for Burroughs. He had to go far to his left, which he is supposed to do, but he got back really off the line a little bit and was deeper than he normally would be and tried to throw across his body and threw the ball away.
The old Eddie Stanky theory that you close up the middle and play your third baseman very close to the shortstop. So Burroughs is able to come over. Pretty good speed by Gary Green. I'm not sure he would have had him anyway. They do give him an error. So if you're scoring along with it, it's an E5 on Burroughs.
So the strikeout string is broken. Six in a row retired on strikes by Roger Clemens. And that will bring up Chris Beck.
This guy was great against Missouri, John. He can't handle a bat. He's a switch hitter. We'll have to take a look and see if Gary Ward has anything on. Ward is tough to read, given signals, because he's tough to pick. They're bunting.
Clemens will go to first.
Lost it in the sun. Lost it completely in the sun. The runner around third will hold. Runners at second and third for Oklahoma State. Totally lost the ball in the sun.
Truly unfortunate, because two routine plays as Clemens, after striking out the side in the first and second, is in a jam now simply because of just a matter of events. This is unfortunate for Tolentino. The sun is very low right now, about to sink. He loses it completely. Boy, I tell you what, runners at second and third, John, on a couple of ground balls that weren't hit very hard. One a bunt, obviously, and then the first play.
So runners at second and third with nobody out, and after striking out six in a row, Roger Clemens has fallen on some tough times.
Really has. The number down to third and then the bunt, which both teams were executing well. Unfortunately, the sun is something you don't figure on.
No official word on the scoring. That's a tough one to score, you know.
It really is. I guess you got to go with Tolentino, but it's one of those errors that you just like to forget.
Randy Whistler is the batter. Randy fouls it back. His average is 296.
Waiting for this guy to really blossom, John. He was drafted by Chicago out of high school. The first player in the state of Oregon. He grew up in Kalmuck Falls, went to Union High School there. Been waiting for him to really blossom. He's very quick, might be the quickest guy on the team. He shared the spot this year with O'Donnell.
And Whistler is in the lineup in the number nine spot in the order for tonight's game. Chance to help his team out. Texas up by one, but the Cowboys of Oklahoma State have runners at second and third, and nobody out. The runners are Gary Green at third. He reached on an error by the third baseman. Chris Beck then is down at second, reached when Tolentino lost the ball in the sun. So
our
that
scorecard
makes it tough for Clemens.
I was going to say, excuse me, John, our scorecard says E5 and E3, and that's not a Cliff Gustafson ball clip, but they were really unusual circumstances. They'll show up in the box score tomorrow. It looked like they had a bad day. Burroughs had a tough play. Tolentino was just fighting the elements.
So a chance for the Cowboys to get even and maybe take the lead. 1-1 to Whistler. Ground ball to short. Through the legs of the shortstop. It's a 1-1 game. Mike Brumley commits the error. You called it. I don't think I've ever seen a Texas team do that.
You know, this is routine. You're talking about a routine play for a guy who's normally a very good shortstop. Let's see if he just picks his head up. You got to drag it to the belt. He just doesn't get down. You've got to sit on the ground ball and drag the glove so that you wear it out on the back of the glove. You know, Gary Ward had a late decision here to make as Trent came across. Ward is very, very intelligent. With nobody out, he holds him up. If there were one out, you would have seen Beck sprinting for home.
Well, if you're Roger Clemens, you got to be talking to yourself.
Really do, because they haven't hit the ball at all. Give him a roll of tape, they'll hit 100, he says. Got to keep in mind, Clemens has struggled this year. You know, he needs a morale and confidence builder. Comes hard in the first two innings, has looked good in this inning, and now he's tied up and he's in danger of losing it right now because the top of the order's coming up.
Let's go downstairs to Jim Price. Jim?
Hey, you think you guys are stunned over these three errors that the Texas Longhorns have had? You should be down here by the dugout. The coaching staff and the players are all in disbelief. They can't believe those plays either. They say, guys, we got to get it together. Now back to you.
Jimmy, while we got you now, could you tell, did Brumley just look up at the runner at third trying to go to the dish?
Yeah, I thought he did. I think that's a very good observation. Looked like he looked up and brought his whole body up a little bit, Irv.
It's a ball to Tim Knapp. He struck out his first time up. We're tied at one. Cliff Gustafson. Can't go out and catch them for them, Cliff.
No, you really can't. You put them in position. That's the best you can do. The infield half and half. They'll turn two up the middle with Brumley and Bates. At the corner, Burroughs, if he gets the ball hit on the left side, they'll turn it over right at him. He'll check the runner at third and then do something.
If he can get it on the ground, it'll score a run. Fly ball to left field.
We'll
Johnny Sutton will make the play. Let's take a look. Back at third, bluffs the start and goes back. Not deep enough off the bat of Knapp. One out in the inning.
Once again, with nobody out, Gary Ward does not risk it here. Sutton doesn't have a great arm. The ball doesn't come in one hop. He was a little off to the left side. Now the double play would bail him out, so they'll go half and half again with Wade coming up.
Gary Ward does not look very happy down in third. I'm not sure whether he is unhappy with himself because the throw was offline.
That's the kind of guy he is. He's a perfectionist. I saw him win an extra inning ball game here 2 years ago. After the game, he was throwing his shoes into the, his spikes, that is, into the travel bag, and he was upset like he'd lost because he didn't think he had done a very good job coaching. Here's the throw to first that they used, and Tolentino ran at him, said, don't throw it, I can't see it. They'll step off, fake the third, John, and try and come to first, and Tolentino can't see with that low sun.
Still runners at the corners for Scott Wade. Wade, a strikeout victim, one of six in a row in the first two innings. The runner at third now is still Chris Beck, and over at first it's Randy Whistler. Three errors in the inning. Whistler running. The ball's hit to right center field. LeBay makes the catch. The runner from third will score easily, and Oklahoma State leads it 2-1.
Gary Ward had Beck on the move, and Wade is able to get the bat on the ball. That's what you're hollering at third base. Give me a fly ball in this situation. So Ward can feel a little better about what has gone on now after he held on the first ball, hit the Sutton. We've got ourselves a 2-1 ball game with the Cowboys.
Batty's 42. Lynn Edwards.
So the official decision has been made. Tolentino will get charged for the error for losing the ball on the Sun. The errors are charged to the third baseman, the first baseman, and the shortstop. Both runs are unearned. Glenn Edwards is the batter now against Roger Clemens. I'll tell you what, Roger's held up all right out there under this situation.
A couple of ground balls, a bunt, a couple of fly balls. Just unfortunately, he's down 2-1. I like his stuff. He isn't overthrown today. His pitching coach has done a very good job with him. Clint Thomas has got him in front of that videotape machine. They've worked hard to get him out of that little problem that he's had. You know, John, it's easy to overthrow, as you know, working with those Pirates. One little mistake and things just don't happen good for you.
A little conference between Gary Ward and the home plate umpire Hank Roundtree. I don't know what this is about. Jim Price, are you still down there? You have any idea what they're talking about?
Yeah, I'm still here, but I don't have any idea what they're talking about other than the ball that the catcher threw back. I don't know if he rubbed it up a little bit or not.
Well, ever since Gaylord Perry the spitter, maybe he's got a little Vicks on him, and they're starting to wonder.
Lob toss to first base. No balls in one strike.
Those good spitball pitchers, John, like Eddie Bain from Arizona State, who's here at the tournament. You get close and it smells like a medicine cabinet.
Base hit left field. Runners at first and second. A single by Glenn Edwards. That's the first hit of the ball game. The Cowboys of Oklahoma State, even though they've already scored two
batter
runs
15,
against Roger Clemens.
Catcher, Robbie Wine.
And it brings up the cleanup batter, Robbie Wine. Robbie, a strikeout victim, his first time up.
Two out with Wine coming up. Of course, Gary Ward will just let Wine swing the bat. Unlike, say, in Arizona State, John, they will run anytime. Oklahoma State will not run in this situation, and they'll just see if Wine can get something he can drive. Very strong hitter. He pulls the ball.
They're averaging 8.5 runs a game compared to the Texas average, which is also pretty high at 7.4. But the home runs, how about 88 for Oklahoma State, 33 for the Longhorns?
That's amazing. And they were in a region where Oral Roberts, I believe, if I've done my homework correctly, had 96. Now, that's a lot of home runs in one regional.
Well, they also played in a regional with Wichita State, and you know the kind of power they generate there.
Gene Stevenson has a few folks that can go downtown. I read a an article about Gene Stephenson way back in April that he was thinking about going to Miami with Ron Frazier, the defending champs, as an assistant coach. I haven't had a chance. I didn't see Gene. I don't think he made it to the tournament this year as a spectator.
Ball and a strike to Wine. Now he takes strike two. Runners at first and second. There are two outs in the inning.
Clemens gave him his slider that time, John, and kept it on the black part of the plate. That's what they try and get Wine with. Keep the ball away. Keep it away from him.
Oh. Now it's two and two. The inning started with three consecutive errors by the Texas defense. One at third base, one on Jose Tolentino, the first baseman, when he lost the ball in the sun, and one on Mike Brumley. The Cowboys have converted that into two runs on the scoreboard. Just one hit in the inning. Wine is still alive.
Robbie Wine had the best thinking play we've had at this tournament the other night against Stanford. When he decoyed on that play, the relay from the outfield, John, maybe as good a play as we've seen in the College World Series as far as everybody doing their job. The left fielder threw the ball just right to Green, and then the pump to the plate, and Wine with the outstanding decoy. It's key play of the game.
Struck him out. Robbie Wine down on strikes for the second time. Three errors add up to two runs for the Cowboys of Oklahoma State. They take a 2-1 lead over the Longhorns of Texas. Coming up for the Longhorns in the third, Burroughs, Bates, and Brumley.
Hey, if you think we have an exciting ball game here tonight, wait till tomorrow night. Michigan coach Bud Middle, you've been very successful, Bud, back here again. A big game against Alabama tomorrow night.
It sure is. It should be a pretty good ball game. I think good offensive club in Alabama, and hopefully we'll have some good pitching to hold off that attack.
Have you ever seen a hitting club like Alabama? They come out cutting and slashing out of that dugout.
That's the best hitting club I've seen so far this year.
Can you stop them?
Well, we're going to try.
Okay, good luck to you, Bud.
Thank you
for stopping by. Hey, we got a dandy here. Now back to you, up to you two skinny guys upstairs.
Thank you very much, Fatso.
Those two Michigan guys talk that same language.
Yeah, they do.
I'm just kidding him. Jim Price is slim and trim coming in this year. We're going to talk about the official scoring decision that was made in that last inning on the error to Jose Tolentino. Ground ball to the right side. First baseman makes the play, and Brian Burroughs is out number one in the third. You know, it was a tough call for Lou Spry.
Well, Lou Spry has been scoring for 32 years, and he came over and he made an interesting observation. Why shouldn't that be a base hit, John? You give a guy a base hit on a fly ball when you lose it in the sun to an outfielder. Why not in this situation? And, you know, it kind of penalizes both players in this situation. I don't think you should get a base hit, but the error is the one I'd be more concerned with.
Well, because the ball was thrown, the error is charged. The batter is Bates now. Bates got a base hit his first time up. It was picked off of second by Robbie Wine.
If you are keeping track at home and the number of pitches, Clemens now has thrown 48, so that means he's averaging 16 an inning, and that's right on schedule if you're going to get a win.
Outside corner, good pitch.
This kid's tough. He keeps everything down, does get a lot of ground balls. By my scorebook, he's picked up 7 out of the 9 thus far, so he's doing what he's supposed to do.
Fouled back. Now it's 2-2 with 1 out. Texas scored first with a single run in the bottom of the second. Then Oklahoma State with 2 unearned runs in the top of the third inning. 2-1 is the score here in Omaha. Game number 7. Delighted to have you with us as we continue our coverage of the College World Series for 1983. I'm John Chandler, along with Jim Price and Herb Brown.
Take a look at Bates. Reminds you so much of Spike Owen, the kid who's in the Seattle organization this year. Does overstride, as I mentioned. That means that you are a little vulnerable to the curveball. But look, he gets a hard pivot, stays on that back foot, does stride on the inside spike, which is so important if you're going to handle pitches on the outside half of the plate. Too many times, John, if you stride on your heel, you hit only one pitch. It better be in your wheelhouse. If you get the ball away from you, you've got no chance if you're on your heel. Step on the inside spike.
3-2 pitch. Slaps it down the third baseline. Back in the shortstop going down, it's Gary Green to run down the fly ball in foul territory. One other scoring note for those of you who like to keep score along with us. Going back to that same play we've been talking about.
Mike Brumley.
Chris Beck does not suffer. He gets credit for a sacrifice, so it is not a time at bat. There is an error charge, but the sacrifice is what he was doing and what he did.
Right.
Well, Mike Brumley has switched from the outfield to the infield. What kind of adjustment for him?
Well, it was a big adjustment for me. It's just a lot different outlook as far as center and playing short.
I just mainly the big difference is you have to concentrate more defensively.
And of course, Mike did commit an error in that third inning. Grounds it down the first baseline. Fair ball. It's a 1-2-3 inning. A pop up and a couple of ground outs to the first baseman. We have played three in Omaha, Nebraska. It is Oklahoma State 2, the Longhorns of Texas 1. Coming up, it'll be Gorman, Incavilia, and Green. It is World Youth Soccer Championship, the USA and Poland, live here on ESPN, your Total Sports Network, 4 o'clock Eastern Time, 1 o'clock Pacific Time on Wednesday. Be here to see the soccer stars of tomorrow. What we're seeing right now are some of the baseball stars of tomorrow. As far as the major leagues are concerned, the eyes of Texas are upon Omaha, Nebraska for the College World Series.
Hook 'em horns. There's a Nebraska shirt. I knew they'd get it up. There's a big red fan saying, Tom Osborne, we're with you. Schmidt's doing some kind of job, John. He is throwing 37 pitches, an average of 12 an inning. In his last 115 outs, 9 double plays behind him. That's the story of Oklahoma State and Schmidt.
The Cowboys leading by a run as Joe Gorman leads it off. He struck out in the second inning, batting now in the fourth. Credit runner Roger Clemens was settling down after the three errors had been committed. He got a couple of fly balls in a base hit and picked up his seventh strikeout. That would unnerve a lot of people, I guarantee you that.
Really would. The guy, it's unfortunate what happened that inning, because that is not a typical Texas effort. The guy at the dish, Gorman, hit one dead center over the fence at All Sports Stadium, Oklahoma City. Those of you who've been in that park, that's not easy for a college kid. They play the Big 8 tournament there. That is a poke.
Right center field. LeBay runs it down.
Ball was hit pretty good. It looked like it was going to be a gapper, but LeBay has got good speed. Out of Angleton, Texas, Angelina Junior College. They call him Smooth, and he was smooth there.
So Roger Clemens goes back to the mound. The three errors behind him in this game ties the Texas record for the year. That's for an entire game, not an inning.
John, both these teams are in very competitive conferences. Texas won the Southwest, but Norm DeBrine down at Arkansas and Houston under Roland Walton were very competitive. DeBrine had a kid drafted today, 7th. We'll pick it up.
Check swing roller to short. Brumley's throw is high. The out is recorded. The first baseman, Tolentino, looked like a linebacker.
And I got to tell you, that Incavilia, that little freshman, took a look at Tolentino and said, wait a minute. Hey, I'm just 18 years of age now. We can talk about this. We're talking about Norm DeBrine at Arkansas as Tolentino's got that smile. Well, let's pick up. Let's take a look at this again because the action is pretty good. All right, here they are. A couple of pretty good pieces of meat right here. Incavilia got a little size, as a Tolentino. And the first base umpire, Dick Runchy, says, no nonsense. I'm going to finish the story on DeBrine's kid. Darrell Ackersfeld was an outstanding pitcher down at Arkansas. He transferred to Mesa Junior College. Today, he was drafted 7th. In the entire country, and Norm DeBrine has got a good program. Norm Roberts played well for him this year.
Gary Green, the batter, pops it up into short center field, drifting out his Bates. Still backing up, makes the catch. 1-2-3. The Cowboys go in order. We played 3.5 in game number 7. 2-1. Oklahoma State is leading Texas. The Longhorns, Hodo, Tolentino, and Heron are coming up. Longhorns coming up, down by a run in the bottom half of the fourth inning. Oklahoma State 2 and Texas 1. Little collision at first base.
Well, once again,
Cavilla and Tolentino.
Boy, I'm going to tell you, Tolentino got the best of that because he gets him in the throat. That's where all the street fighters go for anyway. This is the maniac. I'm not sure Cliff is in that kind of a mood right now. This is John Rauch. We saw him first, John, with South Carolina. Yeah, Cliff's still laughing.
More baseball from Omaha tomorrow night, Tuesday, game number 8, Michigan and Alabama. It'll be live here on ESPN. That'll be a good matchup. Alabama comes out swinging the bat, as Jim Price mentioned. You were with the guy last night who picked Michigan to win it all, said they have the best players.
Lee Albrecht, last year, the executive director of the college coaches picked Miami, so let's see if Lee is a psychic and knows what he's talking about.
Doug Hodo, the designated hitter, will lead it off. Doug bounced into a double play in the first inning. 2 runs, 1 hit for Oklahoma State. 1 run, 4 hits for Texas. The Longhorns have committed 3 errors. Good crowd on hand in Omaha tonight for game number 7. Eric Schmidt, 20-year-old junior from Quartz Hill, California. Ground ball, second baseman, Whistler, boots it.
One of the problems when you play so deep as Whistler is, the ball will come up very, very fast, and Schmidt continues to get him to hit it on the ground. This ball is hit pretty sharp by Hodo. Whistler, youngster out of Oregon, gets a start ahead of O'Donnell. Is back with his spikes on the grass when he ends up. There's the ready and then the set spot. He pivots, crosses over. There's the spikes on the grass. The ball hits the lip and comes up.
So it is an error. It's the fourth error of the ball game, the first on Oklahoma State. And Texas now with Jose Tolentino. Jose singled to open the second inning, came around to score the run for Texas. Joe Gorman will hold the runner on, and we'll see what kind of a move Eric Schmidt has. A 2-1 ball game here in the bottom of the fourth. Left field, Scott Wade near the warning track to make the catch. The runner will retreat. Hodo back to first. Tolentino hit that ball pretty good, went the opposite way with it.
He did. He showed me something there. Got something out in front of him, goes with the pitch. It's all for naught as Wade was playing him deep. Pretty good outfield with Wade, Knapp, and Edwards. They cover pretty good. Here's a good strong swing. Notice he keeps that right shoulder tucked. That's the key to hitting the curveball. In this case, he gets the fastball low and away. And it's an F7 if you're scoring with us.
Heron, the catcher, is the batter. Takes a strike on the outside corner. He had a base hit his first time up. Got as far as third.
Robbie Wine just sitting on that outside half of the plate. And Schmidt has been able to hit the black part. He looks tough.
Oh, he just blew that pitch by him.
I like this guy. He's 7-0, and once again, he didn't beat the Little Sisters of the Poor. Wichita State, Oklahoma can swing the bat. We were talking about the Southwest Conference race. Oklahoma and Nebraska, coached by Enos Seymour and John Sanders, had some good people. OU with Ray Hayward. Nebraska, Turner Gill, that's kind of a familiar name. Can you imagine, John, what would happen if Nebraska ever gets in the World Series or Creighton, either one of those schools? This place won't be big enough to hold all of fans.
I was going to say the same thing. They don't have enough bleachers to hold those people. The error by Whistler, by the way, his first in 125 chances, third in the last 44 games. So he's been excellent defensively. Down on strikes goes Jeff Heron, out number two.
Let me correct something I said. We were talking about the Big 8 Conference, not the Southwest. Let's take a look at the good, hard fastball by Schmidt as he turns it over. Notice how it runs into the hands of Heron, that is. He turns it over by just throwing that little Scrooge effort.
First strikeout of the ball game for Schmidt, and LeBay fouls it out of play to the right. LeBay now in the College World Series, still 3-for-6. He laid down a beautiful sacrifice bunt his first time up.
Angelina Junior College, he's a very good defensive outfielder to go along with the skills at the plate.
Play the flag.
Schmidt had a pulled muscle in the fall, and they didn't throw him much. They didn't use him very much early in the spring. Tom Holliday brought him along in short relief. Now that it's warm, as you can see, he's doing some kind of job. He's in command now after that problem he had in the second inning.
And also Steve LeBay has done quite a bit of pitching. His record is 7-2. Appeared in 13 games. LeBay, a very versatile young athlete. Two outs, runner at first for the Longhorns. Again, Steve fouls it away.
John, I got to believe Gary Ward is very comfortable with what he's seeing from Schmidt because he's around the plate. He's getting him to hit the ball on the ground. That's what they asked him. There's a look at Ward. Well, he is intense. I don't believe you better lap on the bus coming over with Ward.
Outside corner, he's gone on strikes. The inning is over, no runs for the Longhorns of Texas. We've played four in Omaha. It's 2-1. Oklahoma State leading the University of Texas as we get set to go to the fifth inning.
Hi again, everybody. We hope you're enjoying our coverage of the College Baseball World Series from Omaha, Nebraska. When we left the game, Oklahoma State leading Texas at the end of four innings, 2-1. We're going to move to further action. The Cowboys have scored single runs in the fifth and sixth innings on run-producing singles by Glenn Edwards and Gary Green. So when we return to the game, Okie State leading Texas as we go to the top of the seventh inning, 4-1. Oklahoma State, hope you enjoy the rest of the game, everybody.
Bottom half of the seventh inning for the Longhorns. They're down by three. Tomorrow, game eight, live here on ESPN. Michigan and Alabama, it all starts at 8 o'clock. Hope you'll join us on your Total Sports Network, 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 5 o'clock on the West Coast, from a jam-packed Rosenblatt Stadium. We're getting set for the bottom half of the seventh inning.
John, talking about that ball game tomorrow, a chance to see Magnin, the third baseman from Alabama. He is something else. Five straight hits the other night. Doesn't look like he ought to be able to swing the bat the way he unloads. His hands are too high. He's something.
Jose Tolentino, a base hit and a run scored in the second. And he flied to left his last time up. He's one for two. 4-1, the Cowboys lead. Let's go down to Jim Price, who's checking up on the condition of Heron. Jim?
Yeah, that Texas Longhorn catcher, he's a tough one. I asked him as he walked by, I said, hey, Jeff, where'd that ball hitch as we take a look at it? He said, that ball came up and hit me on the neck, and he said, I'm all right, don't worry about me. He's a tough one, but he said it got him on the neck. They heard, I know from experience.
No balls and two strikes. Tolentino.
John Schmidt has retired 15 of the last 16 as we get a look at his coach, Gary Ward. Nine in a row, the only Texan to reach base by that error.
We're in the bottom of the seventh. An excellent pitching performance thus far. Tolentino pops it up. Chris Beck in foul territory makes the catch. One out.
Well, Jeff Perry.
Jim Price revisit. He's up in the stands. He's everywhere.
Where'd you get that hat, Jim?
He's talking better, though, don't you know? That pitch showed me something. He hit Tolentino in the fist. Pops him up. Full hitter goes down with a mild pop-up to Beck.
Here is Jeff Heron, the catcher. One for two at the plate. Third straight trip to the College World Series for both Texas and Oklahoma State. 23 times the Longhorns have been here. 13 times for the Cowboys. Line drive center field. Base hit. Heron hit it like a bullet.
First mistake Schmidt has made in five innings. He came up with the ball. He's not very happy with himself. And Heron, after getting hit in the throat, comes back and drills one.
23, Steve LeBay.
So Heron is the base runner, and LeBay will be the batter. Coach Gustafson has put on the warm-up jacket. Temperature as we started the game was 70 degrees. The wind was coming from the northwest. 10 to 15. It's now really dropped down, Herb. Very little wind blowing out in center field at all at the present time. It's pretty much still.
We'd be remiss if we didn't mention that Gus has a youngster playing on the ball, but Darren Gustafson is an infielder.
Another line shot to center field, back-to-back singles. Those are the kind that'll make you, if you're a pitcher, run for cover.
Starting to get the ball up a little bit. Oklahoma State has got activity in the bullpen. Tom Holliday, got a look at him, and he got very concerned because the ball has come up.
Jim Price.
Yeah, you know, I think Schmidt is still throwing as good as he ever was. I like this pitching scheme up until these last two hitters. He had him looking for the sinker ball. He was going away, especially on the left-handers. Then he'd jam him in tight. Interesting thought that I think about. They talk about the jugs gun and the radar gun about fellas playing pitching or throwing 85 miles an hour to 90. It doesn't matter how hard you throw it. It's the movement on the ball and how the hitters can pick it up. And I think Schmidt is one of those pitchers. He may only throw 80 to 82 miles an hour. I think he's difficult to pick up.
John, Jimmy, it makes great sense. Do you remember a guy playing at Southern Illinois in the outfield by the name of Dave Steve? They happened to put him on the hill one day.
Right.
And what Jimmy mentions is so true. Everything he throws starts moving the minute it comes out of his hand. I've never seen a slider like that since Andy Messerschmidt. And Jim, you were talking about sliders. We were sitting around the pool one day. Nolan Ryan has a slider that's in another league.
I tell you, there's another league. He deserves to be in it because he throws that fastball about 95. The slider's about 96.
Do they call for volunteers late in the game against Ryan? Because he's still throwing about 90 miles an hour.
I was never anywhere to be seen when they were looking for someone to bat against him.
LeBay at first, Heron at second, one out. After that long stretch in which he retired 15 of 16, the only man to reach base and did so on an error, you have to go all the way back to the second inning for the last time the Longhorns had a hit, and they have two of them. And it is Henneman warming up. Another one of the players who was drafted today by Oklahoma State. Henneman in the bullpen was picked up by Philadelphia in the second round of the secondary phase. There he is getting loosened up.
Ball is up again. Schmidt threw that higher than any pitch he's thrown today. Tom Holliday is concerned. You can see why. He's quit bending his back. Let's see if he gets this one down.
It's up again.
Sutton is the batter. He's 0 for 2 tonight. He does have an RBI.
Schmidt must keep it down to be effective. That's been a book on him all year long. He's undefeated, 7-0, and he's really been tough. But this inning, the baseball has come up. The last four pitches have not been what he wanted.
On the corner, he gets the call. 2-1. Longhorn fans looking for a rally here in the bottom of the seventh inning. 4-1, Oklahoma State on top. Jim?
Now he's aiming the ball instead of letting it fly, let it go with his natural rhythm. I can notice the last couple pitches he aimed it, even though he got a strike in there the last time. Let's see what he does here.
And it's 3-1.
John, that time he drops down, goes three quarter, and still the ball is high. The only strike he's throwing to this hitter, Sutton, it was a high strike, and Sutton was taken all away.
The other pitcher warming up for the Cowboys is Gary Kanwisher. Well, they have two pitchers throwing. There's the strike. 3-2 now.
He did aim that pitch, as Jim Price pointed out. The ball was down, but it was a lollipop. Sutton taken all away. I'm sure he'd have liked the green light from Cliff Gustafson on that pitch. 3-2.
See what the runners do with one out. Runners at first and second.
Doubt if Gus will run and be concerned about a line drive hit at somebody, even though he'd like to stay away from double play.
They are not running. The ball is looped toward the dugout and out of play. So the count remains 3-2, and we'll have to do it all over again. Tolentino fouled out to start the inning. And then Heron and LeBay with line drive singles to center field, back to back. Eric Schmidt has given up six hits. Two in the first, two in the second, and two so far here in the seventh inning. Okay, we're set for another payoff pitch, 3-2. Center field base hit. Heron around third, headed for home. The throw is cut off, and it's a 4-2 ball game.
It's amazing how you can just be breezing along. Schmidt was sensational, retired 15 out of 16. He gets Jose Tolentino on that soft pop to third. And since that time, it's been three straight shots up the middle. Gary Ward will not make the change. If the change comes, it's from Tom Holliday. He'll tell you, that's why I hire a pitching coach. That's why I pay him. Gary Ward lets the man work.
Batter number 8, Mike Trent.
So now it's Mike Trent. The base hit and the RBI go to Johnny Sutton. It's his second RBI of the night. He has three so far in the first two games. Down at second is Steve LeBay.
Trent hit the ball a ton in the second inning. Fine running catch by Knapp, so he's capable. They're getting serious down in that first base bullpen.
Trent struck out his last time up, 0 for 2 tonight. 3-4-6 now in the College World Series in 83. 4-2 the score. The Longhorns fighting back. Way outside. Derek Schmidt breezing into this inning, but he certainly lost his rhythm and his control.
Really needs a double play here to bail him out. That's been the aid all year long. 9 double plays and 115 outs coming into this ball game. If he keeps it down, Green and Whistler have the ability to turn it over. His problem, as Jim Price pointed out, he's been aiming the ball. Did some lollipops this inning.
Missed again. 2-0. Now he's really digging himself a hole.
Big decision in that first base dugout for Tom Holliday. Now, how far do you go with Eric Schmidt, because the rhythm is gone now.
Runners at first and second. One out in the inning. Texas has scored a run. There's the strike.
Tommy Holliday played in this tournament with University of Miami, signed a pro contract, I believe, with the Pirates. He was the Arizona State pitching coach for a while. He's just outstanding. He had a shot at the LSU job. Skip Bertram, the assistant in Miami, finally got that job.
Skip had been in Miami for a long, long time, too. 3 balls and 1 strike. fact, you know, they joke Ron Frazier that Ron is always out promoting, and Skip was doing the coaching.
Well, Ron can promote the Bob Hope lookalike. We missed him this year. I thought he'd be here to watch the tournament. They got beaten in their regional.
Full count again. Second straight batter that he's gone 3-2 on. Sutton got a base hit to drive in the second Texas run.
John, I believe that this was a right-handed hitter. Gus would start the runners with a left-hander. If you get a strikeout, it's an easy throw down the back. So I don't think he'll start the runners. I believe it was a right-hander. Down two, he would.
Three balls, two strikes, one out. The Longhorns have scored once, looking for more. Long drive, right field. Between second and third, the lead runner thought it was a home run. LeBay thought the ball was gone. It was not. It's an RBI double, and it's a 4-3 ball game.
John, that really hurt because they were into their home run trot, and it's very unfortunate for Texas because they would have had this thing tied up. Here's Tommy Holliday looking on. He has made no move thus far. Here's Edwards. The ball should get him in the head. Comes off hard. Texas, the runners did slow down into the home run trot. Boy, that's a shame. Let's take another look. Off the sign, the command performance.
It hit about maybe 2 feet from going out, came down and hit him on the head, and he had to regain his composure and try to find the ball. The only reason they didn't circle the bases is because the runners thought it was a home run, and it very nearly was.
Ooh.
Now, the right fielder is being administered to right now, Glenn Edwards. He took a good jolt to the head.
Have you ever seen a ball come down that was hit that high, come down at that angle?
I never have. It almost like it skipped.
Brown, now batting.
But the runners were not running. They were celebrating.
This is unfortunate because they may live to regret this one. Look, they're in their home run trot, and the ball is in play. They should have a man on third with one out and the score tied. Now, Robbie Wine, that is almost able to throw the runner out here at second.
They get a run out of it. Credit Trent with a double and an RBI. Two runs have scored for Texas. Brian Burroughs is now the batter.
Now, John, the score is 4-3. We're in the seventh, and Gary Ward has got his infield half and half. And now the third baseman, Beck, moved back. So once again, he is not going to give up a big inning.
Well, if you're Holliday at this point, you've left him in this far. Schmidt has given up four consecutive base hits. Each of them hit like a rocket.
You would think he's done, but once again, Tom Holliday has worked with him all year long. There's a good pitch as he fights back. Now, Burroughs' mission here is to hit the ball on the ground because the infield is deep. Here they are. Even the third would be a tough play at the plate. The ball would have to be hit very sharp to Beck. There's no chance up the middle with Green and Whistler.
Hits it into center field.
We'll have a play at the plate, John.
Here's Knapp's throw. Here's the runner. Tie ball game. The RBI credited to Alan Brown. It was not Burroughs. It was Alan Brown who was on as a pinch hitter.
Brown does his job. He gets the ball up in the air. Here's the tag. And you have two ways to do it. Do you look at your coach or do you look at the play? And in this case, the runner, Sutton, looks at the play, and that's a good move. So they tie it up. John, that should have been the go-ahead run, though, because there would have been a runner at third base. Notice they want him to slide to the left side, and there's a good job of coaching by Billy Bates. We got ourselves a tie game.
Three runs here in the bottom of the seventh inning for the Longhorns of Texas. We're tied at four. Now Bates is the batter. Still a runner at second. The Longhorns have battled back to tie it up. Called strike.
His stuff is back now. The last three pitches he has thrown, and his arm is still lively. So Tom Holliday has apparently liked what he has seen. Look at the determination here.
There's a bunt. Third baseman Beck charging, throwing, and getting. The inning is over. The Longhorns scored three to tie the ball game. We'll go to the eighth inning. A dandy ball game from Omaha, Nebraska. It's Oklahoma State 4 and Texas 4. For the Cowboys, Robbie Wine, Joe Gorman, and Pete Incaviglia due up.
series so far.
Hey, we got a barn burner here tonight, but tomorrow night we're going to have another one, I think. We got Michigan going against Alabama. Assistant coach from Alabama, Roger Smith. It's going to be a good one.
Well, I sure hope, Joe. Jim, we feel like we've got a good ball club. We're playing well right now, but we know that Michigan's going to be very tough, and they played well the other night against Maine, so it should be a good ball game. I hope it's as good as this one.
What kind of problems do they present to you?
Well, other than the fact that they're a good ball club, they can do all facets of the game, good pitching, good defense, can run and hit. Other than that, don't have any problems.
Hey, we're looking forward to it. Good luck to you.
Thanks a lot, Jim.
Hey, up to you there, guys, now.
Okay, thank you very much. Jamie Doughty is going to be the third baseman. The pinch hitter, Alan Brown, came on, did the job, got the sacrifice fly, got the game tied up. Swing and a miss. And there is Jamie Doughty, the new third baseman.
Jamie Doughty is my neighbor, Broomfield, Colorado. Hit a lot of home runs in junior college a year ago. They've got high hopes for him.
It's a 4-4 ball game. Robbie Wine at the plate is 0-3. Struck out twice and popped up.
At third for Texas.
The Wine batting to start the eighth inning. Brand new ball game as the Longhorns come battling back. Struck him out. Third time tonight that Robbie Wine has gone down on strikes. That is 10 in the ball game now for Roger Clemens.
That Clemens has that high fastball really rising as he's got that rhythm back now. Wine has no chance here. So Robbie having a tough time. He's 0-4 with the 3 Ks.
Clemens closing in on a career high. He struck out 11 against Arkansas earlier this season. We're now in the College World Series where the record for strikeouts, I believe, is 20. That's almost everybody.
John, we had a ball game between these two teams 1 year where they set a record for at-bats, 106. They went, I believe it was 15 innings. So they're capable of playing all night. We're in the eighth and it's tied. Don't anybody go anywhere.
One hops it up there to Joe Gorman. Gorman is 1-for-3, and he has scored a run. Texas bullpen continues to be busy. Kirk Killingsworth is throwing. Most strikeouts in a game was a 15-inning game. It's 20 by Steve Arnold. Most strikeouts in a 9-inning game in the College World Series, Ed Bain, 19 for Arizona State.
Eddie is here with Arizona State. He was voted the all-time left-hander. You talked about it the other night when you did the ball game. The all-time left-hander ever. Keep in mind, a guy named Bannister, who became an instant millionaire this year, was an Arizona State product.
Two balls and one strike to Joe Gorman. Joe is 1-4-7 officially in the College World Series. Came into the game batting 368 on the year. Slow hit roller to the second baseman. Bates on to first, one away. Rather two away now. A strikeout and a ground out, two up, two down.
Batter number 29, the DH, Pete Incaviglia.
And the freshman, Pete Incaviglia, will be up. Pete is 0-for-3 tonight. 2-for-6 in the World Series so far. So far tonight, Incaviglia has struck out, grounded out, and flied out.
Clemens has done a pretty good job pitching to this guy. He's 6'1", 220. He set the Big 8 and OSU home run record. Clemens, once again, John, the point that he's throwing up high, they've only had 3 ground ball outs on the Oklahoma State side.
No balls, one strike with 2 outs. They play Incaviglia slightly to pull, just a little bit. Center fielder drifting over a little bit. It almost looks like Incaviglia is not ready when the ball is delivered.
And then his hands really get into action. I think that, you know, he's just a freshman, and at times I get the same feeling. Tell you one thing, Clemens is still throwing hard. Now, he exploded that last one.
Called strike. 1-2 to Incaviglia.
John, this guy started fast with 6 strikeouts. Now he's starting to come on. He got 1 in the 7th. Already got 1 in this inning with 2 strikes on Incaviglia.
3 runs by your offense will do a lot for your adrenaline. High fly ball down the right field line, drifting toward the stands, and a sellout crowd in Omaha, Nebraska will battle for a souvenir. Roger Clemens, 6'3", 205. He's got good size. 20 years old, a junior drafted by the Boston Red Sox. And the way he talked, anxious to get into that organization.
Well, it's a big break for Roger.
This isn't the first time he's been drafted, the Blue Jays and the Mets. What a Blue Jays. We talked a little bit about Dave Steve, but that Clancy can throw.
They've got some pitching, don't they?
They're doing a good job, too. I like the way Bobby Cox is running that ball club. He platoons well.
2-2. Now it'll be 3-2. Incavilla had a notion, held up. The Cowboys of Oklahoma State battling the Longhorns of Texas, two old rivals. Not necessarily always friendly rivals. The Longhorns have had their number in the World Series for the most part, winning the last 2 years and winning 4 out of 6 as they meet for the 7th time in Omaha. Struck him out. Strikeout number 11. That matches his high for the season. Roger Clemens trots off. He retires the side in order. We're tied at 4. Bottom of the 8th coming up. It'll be Brumley, Hood, and Jose Tolentino. Oh, the reaction of Roger Clemens. He gets the... Incavilla's gone. We'll be right back. It's a 4-4 ball game as we go to the bottom half of the 8th inning. Roger Clemens starting to heat it up. He has 11 strikeouts, which matches his high for the year. The intensity of this young man, after his team came back to tie the game, he is coming on strong, and he is keyed up.
Boy, he really is. He's thrown 123 pitches through 8 innings. Leading That's an average of 15 an inning. On the other side, Schmidt is throwing 99, an average of 14. But, boy, that increased dramatically that last inning. This could be a very crucial inning for Eric Schmidt. Let's see if he's got the stuff he showed to the last two hitters in the 8th.
4 runs, 7 hits, 1 error for Oklahoma State. 4, 8, and 3, the numbers for the Longhorns. Texas getting their hits in bunches, 2 in the 1st, 2 in the 2nd, and 4 in the 7th inning as they scored 3 times to tie the game. And the truth of the matter is, if it wasn't for a base running blunder, they might have the lead at this point.
Yeah, really, John, they should be ahead 5-4. Ball comes off the wall, hits Edwards in the head, bounces around, and you don't get a triple out of it because somebody was in their home run trot. It's a base running mistake. I know that Gus isn't very happy with it.
3 balls and no strikes now to Brumley. What Schmidt does not want to do is put that lead runner on with Hodo and Tolentino to follow.
And this guy can run like a deer. You definitely don't want him on.
Call strike, 3-1.
Schmidt had a problem in the last inning aiming the ball, and the last 2 pitches have been lollipops once again. 3-1. Let's see if Brumley's got the green light.
That is the first walk of the ball game by either pitcher. Holiday looking on, the pitching coach for Oklahoma State.
Listen, this guy's tough. Remember last year, his ball club was leading South Carolina 9-1. Kanishar was struggling. They kept closing the gap. He stayed with him. There's a look at Gary.
That's Gary Canwisher, a right-hander. The other pitcher throwing is, I guess there's only one pitcher throwing right now. Earlier we had Henneman throwing, but now it's Canwisher. And Holiday makes his way to the mound. Has he seen enough?
Tom is very hard to figure. He's his own man. And last year, I thought for sure in the South Carolina game that Canwisher would be out of there. He saw something he liked, and he stayed with him. I tell you what, I really like, though, the relationship between Ward and Holiday. This is Holiday's job, and Ward doesn't second-guess him a bit.
It's a long conversation at the mound. The umpire finally says, let's go, fellas. And Holiday will stay with his pitcher for now.
Gus has come up to talk to his hitter, Hodo. Now, there's several things he can do. He's got a lot of confidence in Hodo. First and second situation, he didn't bunt the ball. He had him swinging away. He's got some wheels at first with Brumley. And every once in a while, Cliff will play hit and run. Let's see if that means anything. He looks a little intense. He may be going right here.
Hodo tonight is 0 for 3. He's been on base 1 time on an error. There's the bump. Back to the The pitcher now, Wine, grabs it and throws in time. A little bit of mix-up between the pitcher and the catcher. Finally, Robbie Wine made the play.
It's a pretty good athlete bouncing out of front of the plate here. Jim Price can appreciate this. This guy has had a bad knee. Has to throw it like Brooks Robinson.
24.
They get the out.
Jose Tolentino.
That's it. Here comes Tom Holliday.
So the sacrifice is effective. Score it 2-3 on the put out of Hodo, but Tolentino will not get to see Eric Schmidt. Eric is going to be gone. Eric pitching into the eighth inning.
You know, John, that was interesting because Kanwisher will keep the ball up high. Schmidt keeps it down. It's easier to bunt a ball that's low, and yet they went with him, I guess assuming that they would bunt the ball. Now Kanwisher will come in. Our attendance officially is 14,595, another good crowd in Omaha.
A big crowd tonight, 14,595. On comes Gary Kanwisher. For Oklahoma State, Gary is a sophomore, 19 years old, Hillsdale, New Jersey, 6'3", 190-pounder. This is only his second career relief appearance. 32 of his other 33 games have been as a starter.
We saw him in relief in that other appearance against Stanford.
Right.
He came in, did a very good job.
Well, the numbers on Kanwisher are a record of 9-3. And he does have a one save.
14,000.
He's been busy working 107 and a third innings. 118 strikeouts.
This session record,
96 walks.
The old record for this session, 10,589.
He also has seven complete games. He's been very busy, 9-3. His earned run average is 4.21.
Throws a very heavy ball. He's from Hillsdale, New Jersey. Drafted by the Mets.
Through four sessions.
He was their number one at the beginning of the year. It was a little wild early, and then he lost out to Dennis Livingston. He'll throw that heavy ball, and he'll throw it hard. He'll hurt you. He'll bring the ball into your hands, your right-handed hitter. Look at the strength. Look at the thighs and the kick that he gets. A lot of leg, a lot of glove. Opens up pretty good.
100.
College pitchers are getting bigger and bigger. This one's 6'3", 190, just a sophomore.
14,595 tonight. Total so far,
50,669. So Kanwisher is getting loose out on the mound. He will face Jose Tolentino with a runner at second and one out. Bottom of the eighth inning, tie game at 4-4.
Your attention, please. Number 35, Gary Kanwisher. Kanwisher.
Tolentino in the game tonight is 1-for-3. 1-for-9 in the series.
Spent last summer playing summer ball up in Palmer, Alaska. Drafted by the Giants.
Brumley's on at second with one out. Mike can run. So we'll see what Gary Kanwisher can do. Coming on in relief of Eric Schmidt. His first pitch is a strike. Very important to come out of the pen and throw strikes.
Absolutely, and that's Kanwisher's job. The infielders will be playing deep, trying to knock a ground ball down, make it take two to score here.
Time is called. Now Hank Roundtree will move back. You get a look at the infield.
Back as deep as they can be. Got to knock it down here. Not let anything through.
Tolentino has 12 home runs. Two strikes. Tolentino from Mexico City, Mexico. A couple of weeks ago became a United States citizen, so he holds a dual citizenship.
Got to look at Wine with those signals. Went with the middle one. Let's see if it's a deuce.
Still no balls and two strikes. Tolentino rolling it foul behind home plate.
Pretty good curveball off the table, and Tolentino fought it off. It's on the line right here, John. He's got to get the bat on the ball.
Bottom of the eighth inning. 4-4 ball game. One and two now. Canwisher out of the bullpen. Put up by the second baseman. He was positioned right, and he gets the put out. One and two now. Canwisher out of the bullpen. Put up by the second baseman. He was positioned right, and he gets the put out. Randy Whistler. I'll tell you, nine times out of ten, that's a base hit.
You got to give Gary Ward all the credit. He moved him. When he came to the plate, that's exactly where he positioned Whistler. Boy, what a big bailout. I'm sure if Canwisher could, he'd go out and hug Whistler right now, because that thing had base hit all over it. That would have been the lead run.
Brumley does move up to third on the ground out. Two outs, and he's 90 feet away for Jeff Heron. Heron is 2-for-3 and hit the ball like a bullet in the center field his last time up and scored a run.
John, how'd you like to be Tolentino? You can't hit the ball any better. That's a base hit. It is up the middle, and all it is 4-3.
Brumley is still waiting at third base, trying to get home. And Heron is having a good series. 2-for-3 tonight. He's 5-for-9 so far in the two games. Not bad. They do not make the play, and the Longhorns take the lead. The ball got away from Robbie Wine. He had to track it down the first baseline, and by the time he recovered, the run had scored.
Well, that's something that you just can't coach, is speed. And Brumley on a short pass ball, he has Robbie Wine. I know Jim Price is sitting right down there and watching him. Robbie Wine did a great job blocking the ball, but Brumley can run. Here it is, hip first, gets down. Canwisher a little late getting to the plate, and there's the go-ahead run.
5-4, the Longhorns have taken the lead. The run scores on the wild pitch. And Brumley using that good speed to move ahead of Gary Ward and the Cowboys.
Cliff Gustafson has always had somebody like that. I mentioned Spike Owen before, a guy who just would beat you a million ways. He was a leading hitter in the series last season. Now with Seattle, now Brumley, who was drafted today, gives him the go-ahead run.
Canwisher walks the batter. That run, by the way, is charged to Schmidt.
Right field.
So close the book on Schmidt, 5 runs.
John, if you're looking ahead in the ninth, the last chance for Oklahoma State would be the back of the order. Gary Green, Chris Beck, and Randy Whistler, and Clemens have been throwing good.
2 outs, a runner at first. A wild pitch allowing the go-ahead run to score for Texas. Longhorns coming up with 3 runs in the bottom of the seventh, and 1 here in the bottom of the eighth to take the lead. Great action from Omaha. Hope you're enjoying it. No balls in 1 strike. Oh, the attitude and the atmosphere has changed in that Texas dugout. I know that for sure, Jim Price. They were down in the dumps with the 3 errors earlier. They got to be all keyed up right now. It's no balls and 2 strikes to the batter, Steve LeBay. Steve is 1-for-2. There you see the Longhorns.
It's Calvin Schiraldi, who was drafted today. He threw 88 the other night. That's as fast as they've had anybody throw here in the College World Series. He was a consistent 88 miles per hour.
Now it's 1-2. You know, you talked about it earlier, Irv. The Longhorns always have great pitching, and this year is no exception. We've seen 2 outstanding pitchers in the first 2 games for Texas.
Well, Schiraldi was outstanding, but I'll tell you, Clemens has certainly come back after that problem he had back in the 3rd inning, and he has really been special. They got a lot of depth. They just do a good job down there. That's not by accident that they have so many All-American pitchers. Give this guy and Clint Thomas credit.
Well, of course, you have to also remember the Cowboys scored their first 2 runs on errors. So 2 of the runs were on error. Swing and a miss, he strikes him out. The inning is over, but the damage has been done. The Longhorns have scored a run. After 8, they have taken a 5-4 lead over Oklahoma State. Last chance coming up for the Cowboys. It'll be Gary Green, Chris Beck, and Randy Whistler. Brumley diving home to give Texas a 5-4 lead. Ninth inning is next. Stay with us. The Longhorns coming up with a run in the bottom of the eighth inning to grab a 5-4 lead. Now we go to the top of the ninth, and it's the lower third of the order, Green, Beck, and Whistler. But that lower third of the order has scored three of the runs in this ballgame for Oklahoma State. Out on the mound, Roger Clemens trying to finish it up and become the second Texas pitcher to go all the way this week in Omaha. He has given up seven hits, only two of the runs earned, and he has struck out 11, no walks. Steve O'Donnell will pinch hit for Gary Green.
Batting for Green.
O'Donnell is the second baseman. Pinch hitting here in the ninth inning. Ball to him.
Steve O'Donnell was drafted by the Mets. He's had a hot bat. Did not get the start tonight. Even though his bat is a little slow, he can pull the baseball. Of course, his mission is to get on here any way he can.
And it's two balls and no strikes to him. He has a .395 batting average. Has not hit a home run. He's only played in 41 games. Coming into tonight. 2-1 now.
John, I think this is where a scout really takes a look to see if a guy is a closer now. You find out a lot about Clemens right now in this situation. See if he's a closer.
Off the pitcher's glove, the second baseman. Bates is there throwing in time. Scored 1-4-3.
Clemens really helped himself out because that thing looked like it might go through. I wonder if Bates is hurt.
He was going one direction, Irv, and he had to turn around quickly and reverse and go the other way. I wonder if he twisted his back or something. Let's watch it.
All right, here's the replay. We'll see if we can pick it up. All right, here's the effort by Clemens as he is able to get the glove on the ball. Can't catch it, but Bates comes over, and he was going right, as John pointed out. Makes a hard throw, and it either happened there or on the movement. Now, he's hurting. He's bending down out there, and that's always a good sign when they take the glove off, and he took the glove off, and he is hurt, but he don't want. Look at that. You talk about some pain.
Chris Beck is the batter. Takes a called strike.
Boy, that ball exploded a little bit. He got the leading lady, helped himself out. But he gets a pinch hitter, O'Donnell.
Beck is 0 for 2 officially, has an RBI. Now it's 0-2. Boy, he is throwing.
He really is. You know, that's the thing I loved about Drysdale and Koufax. I don't care how good they threw, they were closers. And that's what you want to see in a pitcher. Can they close? This guy looks like he's going to close. Wants it bad. Look at the determination.
Longhorns trying to advance to a game on Thursday night at 7 o'clock Central Time against the winner of the Michigan-Alabama game. The loser of this game drops down and plays on Wednesday at 5 o'clock. Swing and a miss, struck him out. That's number 12. A high for the year for Roger Clemens. The loser of this game plays Arizona State Wednesday night at 5 o'clock Central Time. That would be next for Coach Gary Ward if his team cannot rally with two outs. The winner goes against the winner of the Michigan-Alabama game on Thursday. And remember, we'll have that Michigan-Alabama game live on ESPN Tuesday night. It'll start at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 5 o'clock out on the West Coast, and that should be a great matchup.
Really should, John. It's interesting because Clemens has come down to talk to the home plate umpire, Hank Roundtree. Look at some of the people who've come up from Austin.
Here is a pinch hitter. Kevin Jagello is the pinch hitter. Kevin Jagello. Number two.
Number two. Kevin Jagello.
So Jagello will pinch in.
Jagello, batting for Whistler.
Two outs. Jagiello shows bunt, takes ball one.
What was the kid's name for Oklahoma State? Benji. And I'm having a problem remembering his last name. The kid that played center field for Gary Ward. This is who the youngster reminds me of.
De La Rosa.
De La Rosa. Benji Della. He was good. Good player.
Two balls, no strikes. Jagiello trying to get on base any way he can. His batting average, 323. Called strike on the inside corner.
I don't know if Ralph Houck is watching, but he ain't going to be too unhappy with what he's seen tonight.
Now it goes 3-1. Two outs. Jagiello trying to get on base and bring up the top of the order. Pull it 3-2. Now the Texas fans really come to life. Fouled back. The Longhorns and the Cowboys.
John, this guy has thrown 9 innings. This is the first full count, and only the second time he's gone to 3 balls.
That's amazing. Base hit left field. The tying run is on for Oklahoma State. Jagiello comes through.
This little guy coming up, Knapp, hit a home run against Stanford. Even though he doesn't have a lot of power, he cranked one that night.
But Jagiello does not have a stolen base.
Number 4, center fielder, Tim Knapp.
There are 2 outs in the inning. Gary Ward looking on. Going to have a pinch runner, I'm pretty sure. That's Kevin Fowler, number 9. So Fowler comes on to run for Jagiello. And Jagiello did his job. It's a tough situation to come into.
He's been doing that all year long. He's an excellent pinch hitter for Gary Ward. With Knapp coming up, even though I mentioned that he cranked one against Stanford, the guy has got a lot of patience. And if he can draw a base on balls here and get the tying run into scoring position and give Wade a shot at him, he's a very unselfish player, Knapp is. I got to believe he'll really make Clemens work.
Going to make him throw strikes. He has a bunt single. 1-3. Inside to him, ball one.
This guy does hold the school record for walks. Tim Knapp should take a strike right here. I know Gary Ward and his strategy. He'll love to have that tying run at second base instead of at first. Then you don't need a gapper. Just a base hit will do it.
Clemens has not walked a batter tonight. Fowler, the runner at first. Tolentino holds him on. 5-4, 2 outs. Top of the 9th inning. Nope, 2-0 now.
Cliff Gustafson's got a right-hander working in the left field bullpen.
Well, he had Killingsworth up earlier.
If you're Sutton, Trent, or LeBay, you cannot let a ball get through and go to the wall here and let that tying run score. You must play deep, and they are, and cut it off.
There's the strike. Two balls, one strike, 2 outs. Knapp takes a good long look at Gary Ward. The Cowboys down by a run. Midwest Regional Champions. Moved him back 3-1. I'll tell you another thing. The Cowboys know about close games. For example, in that regional, they won their last 2 games over Oral Roberts, 9-8 and 10-9. Both a 1-run game.
Right now, Clemens is aiming the baseball. He hasn't done that, John. He's really turned it loose.
There is Killingsworth.
He's had some injury problems, too. Kirk is a very effective reliever, but he has had a problem or two with injuries.
Full count, 3-2. Fowler will be running on the next pitch.
Remember, Fowler's in there because he's got some speed, and a long single, I mean a long single, could conceivably score the run. There's a big gap down the right field line as they play Knapp in right center field. They don't think he'll pull a ball against Clemens.
A full count. Tying run at first, top of the ninth inning. Fouls it away. So Fowler will come back and will do it all over. The one other thing you have to like about Clemens, he refuses to give in to the batter.
I tell you, this has been a couple good ball clubs. Texas had a lapse early on defense, John, and other than that, it's just been excellent college baseball. And you're right, he refuses to give in. He's going to challenge him. He'll make him hit the baseball.
Texas ranked number one coming into this championship event. The Cowboys ranked number three nationally. Here we go, 3-2 again. Base hit into right field. The runner around second hesitates and now has to stop. Back-to-back singles in the ninth inning. Tim Knapp gets the job done, a base hit for him. Fowler really didn't know what to do when he rounded second base.
Right, and Gary Ward, I really didn't look down. I can't tell you if Gary had him held up or not. I think it's the right move in this situation, though. You don't run out of a rally. They've got something going. It's all on the shoulders of Scott Wade, who's still looking for that first one.
So now Cliff Gustafson goes to the mound to talk to his pitcher and his catcher, and he's going to go to the bullpen. So Clemens is unable to finish it off here tonight. He pitches 8 2/3 innings, 9 hits, 12 strikeouts, did not walk a batter. Of the 4 runs charged to him, 2 were earned, 2 were unearned. They'll go to the bullpen, and Kirk Killingsworth will make the long walk.
Johnny's got a bad knee, and we really want to watch him close, because this is an excellent pitcher, but there have been some problems.
Killingsworth comes on. His record is 11-3. 2.63 earned run average. Primarily out of the bullpen. He is appearing for the 30th time, and he has made just 5 starts. So Killingsworth will be the new pitcher.
Killingsworth has a lot of experience. 4 years for Cliff Gustafson, so you know there's a great deal of faith and confidence in this guy. The one thing you have to be concerned about if you're a Longhorn fan, he does have that bad knee, and it has hampered his performance this year.
Well, we really expected this to happen between these two teams.
Yeah. In any surprise.
Good numbers on Killingsworth. 7 saves. Pitched 79 innings. 59 strikeouts to 35 walks. Good ratio. Killingsworth coming on to be the second Longhorn pitcher. Kirk is 6'2", 190 pounds, 22 years old.
This 22-year-old, or 22-year-old, I should say, in the offseason hunts rattlesnakes. Right now,
he does what?
He hunts rattlesnakes.
Oh, sure, everybody does.
Sure. Right now, he's hunting cowboys here because he's trying to save this lead.
5-4, Texas by a run.
He threw good against Wichita State last year. Earned all tourney honors in the Central Regional. Did a great job in the Tulane game. I think maybe as good a job as Kirk has done. The problem has been that knee. It locks up on him. The trainer has to come out and work on him a little bit.
Well, the Longhorns are still one out away from moving on in the College World Series for 1983. The winner plays Thursday at 7 o'clock. Against the winner of the Michigan-Alabama game, the loser drops down in the loser's bracket and will face Arizona State on Wednesday at 5 o'clock. Runners at first and second. It is Fowler, the pinch runner, at second, and Knapp, who got a base hit, at first. Jagiello got the pinch hit single to start it off, then Fowler came in to run for him after the first 2 batters had been retired. O'Donnell hit the ball off the pitcher's glove. Second baseman threw him out. Beck struck out. Jagiello's single. Knapp single. Runners at first and second. 2 outs. Top of the ninth inning. Hang on.
called stuff. And quickly, Heron out to talk to his pitcher.
Well, you're looking at Scott Way. The guy was the MVP and just an excellent regional as far as offensive talent. He's got some power. He's hit 21 home runs this year. He's got some speed, so they're going to have to make a play, something, hit two hops. Seabrook High School, Duval, Maryland, drafted by Pittsburgh, and it's on his shoulders. Look at that determination. That tells it all.
Ground ball through the left side. Here comes the runner around third. Fowler headed for the plate. Here's the throw. Tie ball game. The Cowboys have come back to tie it up.
John, that's what it's all about in athletics. And you saw a young man step up there. Scott Wade has been struggling tonight. He struck out twice. He flat out. He had a sacrifice. And he hit the first pitch, or the second pitch, that is, between third and short. And Fowler, the pinch runner who had hesitated the time before, doesn't hesitate here because Gary Ward has got the green light on all the way. And he'll come in here and score with a head-first slide.
Diving for pay dirt, the Cowboys of Oklahoma State. Here it is again as you look from behind. Sutton's throw.
Sutton's ball does sail on him a little bit as the catcher, keeping that mask on, Heron, is hanging in there. And Kirk Killingsworth isn't out of the woods yet. There are runners at first and third. And Glenn Edwards, who's got a couple base knocks tonight, is the hitter.
Well, it is quiet at the Texas bench. They were at one point one step away from victory. Now it's 5-5.
You know, it's interesting. They got a great effort from the bench. Cadello, the pinch hitter, single. And then Knapp fought off that 3-2 pitch. Clemens was in command until that time.
Swing and a miss by Glenn Edwards. Glenn is 2-for-4 tonight. He has an RBI. The game is tied.
Now, there's some speed at third base if Gary Ward wants to put on the play. This guy can run. This is Tim Knapp, who had the all-time record for a prep as far as stolen bases.
And Wade, who got the hit that tied the game, is on at first. So runners at the corners for Glenn Edwards. That run is charged to Clemens, so he cannot be the winning pitcher. Almost leaned into that pitch.
But Killingsworth threw that thing pretty hard. It sailed on him. This is not intentional. This is not chin music. The ball just gets away. Edwards, as you pointed out, John, is leaning in a la Minnie Minoso.
2-1 now to Edwards. The go-ahead run at third for the Cowboys of Oklahoma State. Fouled back. 2-2 now. There is no quit in either one of these teams.
Hey, you can't. If you play for Ward or Gustafson, you better not. It's just that simple. These are two excellent programs. They're here every year. We've been coming the last 4 years with ESPN. They're here.
Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Oklahoma State has tied the game up.
There he goes.
Struck him out. The inning is over, but the Cowboys come up with a run and tie the ball game up. We're going to go to the bottom of the ninth, tied at 5-5. And for Texas, it'll be the bottom third of the batting order. Alan Brown is now the new third baseman. And O'Donnell is going to be the second baseman. O'Donnell. There he is in the ball game. Now the second baseman.
Should be O'Donnell.
Right.
Things should be over, John. Back in the seventh inning, when Trent hit that ball off the wall, it hit Edwards in the cap. Everybody slowed up. There was a fly ball after that. They would have scored the go-ahead run at the time instead of the tying run. This thing should have been a 6-5 game, but you can't cry over spilled milk. We got ourselves a tie ball game.
Bottom half of the ninth inning. We have basically a new infield now for the Cowboys.
One ball and no strikes to the leadoff batter. Sutton in the game has a base hit and a couple of RBIs. Trying to get this infield straightened out. Alan Brown is at third. Steve O'Donnell is playing shortstop. And Beck is at second base. So that's what they've done. Oh, okay. We have Fowler at third and Beck at second. You got it?
I'm set. Shortstop okay. Is Odell then? Is that correct?
O'Donnell is the shortstop.
O'Donnell, I'm sorry.
Fowler, who was the pinch runner, is at third. And Beck is at second. Okay, Beck moves from third to second. And Fowler plays third. Fly ball down the right field line, headed toward the stands. And out of play. Okay, let's run this down for you so you don't think we've lost our marbles up here. Fowler is the new third baseman.
Steve O'Donnell.
He was the pinch runner. O'Donnell, who was a pinch hitter, will take over at shortstop for Gary Green. And Beck, who had been playing third, goes to second base. And Sutton battling Canwisher. Line drive to O'Donnell, kind of short hops it. Good strong throw. One out.
Nice play. Guy coming in late in the ball game, filling in for Green. Normally, he's a second baseman. Let's take a look at the short hop here. He stays with it, drags it to the belt. Notice he locks up that front foot, jackknifes the back one. Across the diamond to Gorman.
Mike Trent, center field.
It is a 5-5 game. The Longhorns were one out away from winning this winner's bracket game in the College World Series, but a two-out rally, three consecutive base hits by the Cowboys have tied the game. Oklahoma State with 10 hits in the game. The Longhorns have 8. Mike Trent almost hit the ball out of here his last time up. He's hit the ball hard a couple of times, Irv. Hit one deep to center that Tim Knapp tracked down in a ball that just missed being a home run.
Volley hit to right field. I still can't believe that angle, the way it came off the fence and hit Edwards.
No balls, one strike, one out.
It looks like Trent is starting to come out of it. He really struggled with the bat, even though he had some bunt base hits the other night. They moved him down to eighth in the order because of that struggle he's been going through, but he has been swinging the bat good tonight.
He's 4-for-7 so far in the World Series. Ball and two strikes to him. Glad to have you with us tonight in Omaha, Nebraska, along with Jim Price, who's downstairs, and Irv Brown. I'm John Sanders. Game number 7. We're only halfway through with the College World Series, Irv.
Well, you know, when we first started doing this, they'd do a couple of ball games, and then it just, the coverage increased a little bit. Now we do every one of them, and it's just been a fun thing to watch grow with ESPN. They've changed this format.
He strikes him out.
Canwisher showed us a good breaking ball there. Here's Gary Ward now. He's a very, very active coach. It paid off big on Trent's fly ball back in the second inning because Wade, Knapp was positioned perfectly. So Ward takes care of that. He takes care of just about everything except the pitching. The guy next to him, Holiday, does that.
And the batter is Doughty.
He's got a little pop in the bat now. He hit a lot of home runs at the junior college a year ago. This year, he's had a tough time adjusting to Division I.
Jamie Doughty, the batter. Two outs in the bottom of the ninth inning. Might be the second extra inning game of the College World Series coming up. Arizona State and Alabama went 11. Alabama winning to close out the first round games. Dowdy's batting average is only 207.
Yeah, he has struggled. As I mentioned, John, he hit the ball pretty good at Seminole Junior College. fact, he hit 5'10 at Broomfield High School his senior year. He was drafted by the Mets in 81, by the Phillies in the winter of 81, then Seattle. So, you know, you go to junior college, a lot of people take a shot at you. He played last year in Palmer, Alaska.
He's 21 years old, a junior, 6 feet even, 180 pounds. Inside to it. Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Nobody on here in the bottom of the ninth inning. These two teams have gone this route before. Called strike three. The inning is over. We are going to extra innings. After nine in Omaha, Nebraska, it's the Cowboys of Oklahoma State 5, the Longhorns of Texas 5. 10th inning, Wine, Gorman, and Incavelia two up. Series in Omaha, Nebraska, as we get set for extra innings. We expected a good game between the Longhorns and the Cowboys, and we're getting it. 5-5 as we go to the 10th. Each of these teams scrambling back. Texas scored the first run in the second, then Oklahoma State picked up two unearned runs in the third inning. They added single runs in the fifth and sixth and built a 4-1 lead.
John,
no win at all right now.
So I was going to say, boy, that thing is just lying there now.
It was Texas in the bottom of the seventh scoring three times to tie it. Then the Longhorns picked up a run in the bottom of the eighth to take the lead. That run scored on a wild pitch. Then in the ninth inning, after two were out, three straight singles by Oklahoma State, the Cowboys tie it. 5-5 extra innings coming up. Texas is 3-0 in extra inning games this year. Rob Wine has had kind of a tough night. Struck out three times and popped up.
Another guy having that tough night, Scott Wade, had that tying run batted in back in the ninth inning. He had been struggling.
High fly ball, left field. Back to the warning track. Goes Sutton. Off his glove. Wine will stop at second base. He got back to the wall and then could not hang on.
And the ball bounces off his glove about shoulder height, so he really didn't have to leap. It was just a tough one to handle. Here's another look at Sutton, obviously bothered by the warning track. Notice where the contact is. Not that high off the wall. It was catchable. Not an easy play.
Wine
really didn't get out. He thought it was out of here, and once again, he's into his home run trot, too. I'm not sure he could have gotten three bases out of it.
Well, either that or he thought the guy was going to catch it at the wall.
All right, let's see if Gary Ward moves him along here with Gorman. Let's see if he bunts the ball.
Go ahead, run at second base, top of the 10th inning, down the line, foul.
Well, that's
just
a place,
foul.
John, that's a place to take your shot. Hit the ball on the right side. So a team man, Gorman, trying to move the runner up.
It'll go as a double for Robbie Wine. His second hit of the series, first hit of the night. Gorman is 1-for-4. Had a base hit and scored a run in the sixth.
It looks like Gary Ward will take his shots with Gorman, Incavelia. And then my scorecard is messed up. I think it's O'Donnell.
Missed inside. Yes, it will be O'Donnell batting in the spot that was formerly Gary Green's. O'Donnell came in to pinch hit for him and is now playing shortstop. The number nine batter is Fowler. He was a pinch runner for Jagiello, who started that rally off with a two-out single, a pinch-hit single. Just missed.
Pretty good pitch by Killingsworth on the hands. Had Gorman handcuffed. 2-1. Good pitch to hit right here. Let's see what Kirk deals up to Gorman.
The game now in the hands of the relief pitchers, Killingsworth and Canwisher. It's their game to win or lose. 2-1. Runner at second is Wine. Gorman hits it to the right side. Wine will move to third on the putout. So now the go-ahead run is at third with one out.
Did his job. Once again, Gary Ward knows his talent. Instead of bunting the ball with Gorman, he lets him take the shot, shortens up, does not pivot the back foot this time. He keeps the front hip closed so he can go to the opposite side. But now you got a guy who is very capable of giving you a fly ball. Incavelia hit one back in the sixth inning. He also is capable of striking out. Now he's done that twice tonight.
Well, we'll see what he does. The freshman does not have a base hit tonight. He's 2-for-7 in the series, and he has hit a home run.
John, you made a very good observation back in inning number six. At times, it doesn't appear that Pete is ready to swing the bat. He doesn't have it back in that ready position. And that's just a freshman for you, because Oklahoma State's hitters are normally very well disciplined. The infield is in for Cliff Gustafson.
Wade Phillips is working in the Texas bullpen, number 20. Infield in. The Longhorns will try to cut it off. I believe that hit him, didn't it?
Got him on the elbow. Let's see if, I'm wondering if Gary Ward will pinch run for him, simply because you've got to try and keep them from turning two here.
Well, he still has three players left on the bench, Dave, Bell, and Diaz.
All right, fastball runs in to Incavello, and now the trainer is out, probably trying to freeze it right here as they stop between home and first. Incavello will run for himself.
Number five.
He's got to break up too, because I'm sure that Cliff Gustafson will go half and half with his infield.
So now Killingsworth will face O'Donnell. O'Donnell came on as a pinch hitter in the ninth inning. He was the first out in the ninth inning. The tying rally started for the Cowboys after two were out.
John, O'Donnell hit the ball pretty good. That was the play where Clemens deflected the baseball over to Bates, who made that play where he hurt his back. So he made some contact.
Well, with the infield in, if he can drive it up the middle, the Cowboys could take the lead.
And you're absolutely right. I thought that Gus would go half and half, but he's going to go to the dish here, go to the plate.
Big hole on the right side, because the first baseman, Tolentino, will hold the runner. If you're Killingsworth, you got to think about a strikeout.
You really do, and you can't throw anything that's a let-up pitch. You can't afford a fly ball here. He's got to overpower him. You're looking for a pop-up. Come hard on the hands. Ground ball goes through.
Inside corner. Good pitch, good location. One and one now. Runners at the corners. Wine is at third. Incavelia, who was hit by a pitch, is at first.
Wine in very fast down there. He's had the bad knee, so we'll get a bam-bam one at the plate. Gary Ward might not even send him. He might make it be through.
Chopped foul at home plate. So now the pitcher's advantage. He's ahead in the count, one and two. You can see the intensity on the faces of the Longhorns players on the bench. And if you're the pitcher in this spot, you've got to look for a pitch that you can strike him out with.
Absolutely, and once again, you know, you're concerned if you throw that breaking ball. If it's a 55-foot curveball, you can lose the ball game on a wild pitch. Texas took the lead when Brumley was able to hustle in on that breaking ball. So there's a lot of things going through your mind when you're either coaching or on the mound. Let's see what Kirk Killingsworth throws.
One ball, two strikes. Foul again at home plate.
He's keeping it down, John, and that infield is in. It's awful easy to drive a ground ball through. And you really can't change when you keep the ball low, as Kirk Killingsworth has had a habit of doing all his career. It's tough to throw it on the hands and try and pop somebody up.
Killingsworth came on in the ninth inning. He gets the strikeout. Good pitch. Kept
Great
it away
pitch.
From him.
Boy, did a terrific job.
Strikeout number two for Killingsworth. And now it's all up to Chris Beck.
Batter is number second.
And Gustafson second will go to the mound.
Chris Beck.
He has a pitcher warming in the bullpen, Wade Phillips, number 20.
I'm sure one of the things that Cliff is mentioning here is first and third situation, telling his catcher, Jeff Beharin, what he wants done.
Jim Price.
Hey, I'm still here, guys. A little chilly down here, but all the Gus was doing out there was letting his pitcher and catcher know what he wanted to happen if the runner from first base goes to third, and also let him know how to pitch his hitter. Just remind a little bit to keep the ball down. That's all. Nothing too tough. Nice and simple.
Okay, we'll see what happens with Beck. He scored a run, and he's driven one in, but he does not have a hit in the College World Series. He's 0 for 5 officially. Make that 0 for 6 officially. One ball, no strikes to him. Beck looking for that first hit. 5-5 ball game. We're in extra innings in Omaha. A two-out rally. At the top of the ninth, tied it for Oklahoma State at 5. We're now on the top of the 10th. There's the strike. 1-1. And you would have thought when the Cowboys got the runner to third that they had a good chance to get that go-ahead runner.
It's such a great pitch on the strikeout, though, to O'Donnell. It's all on Beck's shoulders now. Another junior college transfer from Pierce. His home is in Hollywood, California.
One ball, one strike, two outs.
He likes to go with the pitch. The ball's on the outside half. He's capable of going to left field.
A roller to second base. Bates on to first. The inning is over. The Longhorns escape. The Cowboys do not score. We'll go to the bottom of the 10th. We're still tied at 5 here in Omaha. And for the Longhorns, it'll be the top of the order. Bates, Brumley, and Hodo coming up.
Coverage of the College Baseball World Series here on ESPN. Just a reminder, right after the game, the Swami, Chris Berman, will be joining me for the next one-hour edition of the ESPN Sports Center. Now, Oklahoma State did not score in the top of the 10th inning. Texas failed to score in the bottom of the 10th. So we're going to go back to the action at Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha. Okie State and Texas tied at 5 as the Cowboys come to bat in the top of the 11th. Hope you enjoy the rest of the game, everybody.
If you like this one, be with us again Tuesday night, Michigan and Alabama. 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 5 p.m. on the West Coast, live College World Series action. Herb Brown, this is why we came here, isn't it?
I would say so. I think we've seen a little bit of action tonight. Let's take a look at the pitch that was taken in that last inning. I thought Canwisher just was outstanding right here. Knee-high fastball. And Groundtree has been giving him the low strike all night long. Very consistent, so that's the third out.
Well, he was wanting the walk, and he didn't get it. So now we go one more inning. We're in the 11th, and we'll see what that does for the Cowboys and their fans to get out of that jam. Fowler will lead it off. He's batting for the first time tonight. Came on as a pinch runner. Kevin Fowler, batting average of .218. He has a couple of home runs.
Kevin scored the tying run.
Yes, he did. Back in the ninth inning. Off the leg of the pitcher, third baseman. Dowdy has it, throws. They get him. And we'll have to check and see if Kirk Killingsworth is all right.
Dowdy did a great job coming in. That's that play that Brooks Robinson made so famous. He'll throw it off the right foot. All right, we'll pick it up. Here's Killingsworth. Remember, he's got a bad knee.
1-5-3.
All right, so here's Dowdy off the right foot, throwing on the run. That's the only way he can make that play.
Top of the order.
Excellent.
The Cowboys. Number 4.
One more time. Dowdy, junior college transfer. That is not an easy play, and he just does a great job here. He gets his runner by 3 steps.
And that knee in the area where he got hit is the knee. It's the right knee that's the problem for him.
And he doesn't have a lot of flexibility. They've got a reliever warming down the left field line. That's unfortunate. Killingsworth will throw a few and see if he can continue. If you're scoring, it's 1-5-3.
Killingsworth is going to stay in. And it'll be the top of the order. Tim Knapp coming up. Let's take one more look,
All right, here's Killingsworth from our center field angle, and he doesn't get down, followed through, because he does have a problem there. Look at Dowdy. Dowdy had a shot to start this year, just didn't work out. Makes a great play there to keep his ball club right in it. They get that leading lady.
It is up to Knapp.
John, we haven't talked a lot about Knapp's effort tying that thing up in the ninth inning. The leadoff base hit by the pinch hitter, and then Knapp comes through to keep it going.
Well, Killingsworth comes back to throw a strike to Knapp after being hit on the leg.
Tim Knapp, 5'9", 160, from Smithville, Oklahoma. Fouled back and out of play, so Killingsworth moves ahead in the count. No balls and two strikes.
Knapp reminds me of a kid who played at Oklahoma State for Chet Bryan about a dozen years ago, the name of Steve Howe. He was one of the leaders in the nation in hitting. Always gets a piece of the ball, just the same way Knapp is, always pesky. Somehow you get on base. That's what Knapp has done all year long for Gary Ward.
11th inning, a 5-5 game. One out, nobody on. Cowboys of Oklahoma State. Knapp down on strikes. So third strikeout for Killingsworth. He's done a good job. 15 Cowboys have gone down on strikes. A total of 9 for the Longhorns, so that's 24 strikeouts in this game.
And John, he really hasn't let that ground ball off his knee by Fowler bother him at all. He bounces back and gets a big K.
So now, with two outs in the inning, Scott Wade, who's had a pretty good night. He has a base hit, a couple of RBIs. He's also struck out twice. We'd be hard-pressed to find anybody who hasn't struck out in this game.
The thing you like about Wade, what a competitor he is, getting that base hit in the ninth after Knapp had gotten a base hit and Fowler was on at second as a pinch runner.
Ball and a strike to him. Randy Whistler did not strike out during the time that he was in the game. So the number 9 spot in the order is the only spot that does not have a strikeout or a K in the box. Two balls and one strike. Killingsworth came on in the ninth inning with two outs, gave up the RBI single to Scott Wade. Also gave up a double to Robbie Wine in the 10th inning. Has not walked a batter. He struck out three. Ground ball to third. Dowdy's long throw. Up the line it goes. The runner on his way to second.
He'll go to three.
Scott Wade around second, puts on the brakes.
Dowdy threw a shot across the diamond, but the ball was wide of the bag. And the first baseman, Tolentino, that'll be the come up with it. Here's Dowdy, who came in for Burroughs when Cliff Gustafson made a move. The ball was thrown like a rifle, but I believe it hit him in the helmet.
Down goes Tolentino. He's had been bounced around a little bit at first base tonight, hasn't he?
Hey, Tolentino says, I might as well get battle pay in the United States Football League the way this is going. There's a go-ahead run at second.
Down at second. The error, number 4 in the game. That's a high for Texas for this season. The first three errors came back-to-back in the third inning, allowing two runs to score. Now they will appeal at first, claiming he did not touch the base. They say, no, he did touch the base.
Well, let's see what they're appealing for here, John. All right, here's the shot. Dowdy, long haul, guarding the line, as he should, late in the ballgame. Here's the throw across the diamond. On the inside of the half of the diamond, and it catches Wade. So he's at second base.
Edwards the batter, a chance to put the Cowboys on top with two outs. Fouls it back. Edwards in the game has two hits. He's 2 for 5, single twice, and struck out 3 times. He drove in a run in the 5th inning. A runner at second. I'll tell you, there have been so many interesting situations in this game. We'll be talking about it for a while.
You know, there always is that type of situation when Oklahoma State and Texas play. I can't remember a ballgame that was ever ordinary. They just really get after each other. Edwards occasionally overswings. Now, he does have some power, and he can run a little bit, too.
Looking for the base hit that will give his team the lead. We're in the top of the 11th. If you just joined us, where have you been? That's high for a ball. 5-5 game. The bottom half of the 10th inning, the Texas Longhorns had the bases loaded. We went right down to a 3-2 pitch. Kanwisher coming up with a big strikeout to keep this game even. That is the go-ahead run in the person of Scott Wade. Edwards hits it into center field. Mike Trent is there. Side retired. We'll go to the bottom half of the 11th inning. We're still tied at five here in Omaha, Nebraska, the 1983 College World Series. Sutton, Trent, and Dowdy coming up. The 11th inning. Gary Kanwisher is the pitcher. We're tied at five, and a lot of the folks in this crowd, a big crowd of 14,595, the attendance for the series now, after 4 days, is over 50,000. Longhorns trying to get something started in the bottom half of the 11th inning. Sutton, Trent, and Dowdy.
24 strikeouts so far, 338 pitches.
We are approaching the four-hour mark in this game. Won't be long. Sutton is 1-for-3 tonight. A base hit and an RBI back in the seventh as Texas scored three times to tie the game. Then the Longhorns, without a hit, took the lead in the eighth inning. But in the top of the ninth, after two were out, the Cowboys put together three base hits to tie it up again. 5-5, bottom of the 11th. I bet there are a lot of people in this crowd who thought that Gary Kanwisher was going to walk in the winning run with the bases loaded, a 3-2 count in the bottom half of the 10th inning. Give him credit.
Young man really came through.
Did.
Right down the middle, John.
Sutton at the plate. 2-1.
Sutton's dad played football at Baylor. Everybody talks about his granddad, Johnny Keene, but his father was a very good athlete. There's the rally caps. Trying
to get the rally caps on.
John, let's say hello to a guy who's looking into Lost Dodds, the athletic director of the University of Texas. He's got to be pretty pleased with what he's seen tonight.
I'm sure he is. I'll echo those sentiments. I knew DeLoss when he was the track coach at Kansas State, where he was also an outstanding performer a few years back. And we also want to say thank you to Bill Little for his help, and congratulations to him. He'll be the new sports information director at the University of Texas, replacing Jones Ramsey, who's stepping down after so many years of fine service down there. You know, we've gotten great help from all of these people. For example, Tim Allen at Oklahoma State. Our thanks to Tim for helping us. And Lynn Nimick, who's been standing behind us passing down notes. Thank you, Lynn. Both of these teams, regardless of who wins this struggle eventually, will still be alive and still in it.
This is a double elimination tournament. This is the big night. Well, a lot of people will tell you Thursday is. If you win Thursday, you're guaranteed that you're in the finals. But if you win tonight, that means your ace is going Thursday against the other team's ace. So it's power against power.
I tell you, we have seen four excellent pitchers, Schmidt and Kanwisher for the Cowboys, and Clemens and Killingsworth have all done the job, basically. Called strike three. Kanwisher gets another strikeout. That's seven for him.
Crowd is hollering. Those are for Texas, but this plate umpire, Hank Roundtree, has been as consistent with his strike zone tonight as you'll see. Watch. The ball is on the knee. He's giving you the low strike all night long. Wine stays down, gives the umpire a good look, and that's strike three.
He rings him up, too. Attaboy, Hank, hang in there.
Hank's been around the horn. You're talking about pitchers. Every year we come here, though, you just see great talent that eventually a couple of them are going to wind up in the bigs. This guy had one, Bert Hooten. Hooten worked out very hard with Gus all spring, really worked hard. You know, Bert Hooten is involved in more no decisions than anybody, I think, going out. And you know, you worked the league, John.
Well, he has the things happen to him that...
Oh, that's Hank, and I tell you, I'm not sure that hit a pad. Oh, that hurt.
Run it off, Hank.
Jim Price can identify with that. He told me that Nolan Ryan once hit him in the hip, and he was black and blue from the shoulder to the hip.
I tell you, those pitches that some of these Texas batters are taking are too close to take in the situations they've been in.
Take a look. A guy we're just complimenting. Watch Hank Roundtree catch one. Just flush. One hop.
Oh, that was not a 55. It was about a 50-foot breaking pitch.
Kanishar is just... did wild enough to keep you loose, boy.
Gary Ward looking on. Hooked up in a good one with the University of Texas tonight. The rally caps, the intensity is there, everything you could want. This is what the College World Series is all about.
Still got to harp back to the last inning when Gary Canvichard threw that third strike. A lot of people really thought it was over, that he would walk in that winning run. Runners of all moving on the 3-2 count. Young guy came through.
Gary did not give up. Texas pitchers.
12 and a third innings without giving up a base on balls. Is that right? Through 11 here.
11 tonight, inning in the third last time. That's a coach's dream when you can do that. Three balls, one strike.
What's an interesting statistic is when you intentionally pass a guy, how many times he scores.
It happens. 5-5 ball game. 11 hits for Oklahoma State, 9 for the Longhorns, and there's a walk. It's the third one that Canwisher has given up. One of those was intentional. So, again, the winning run is on for the University of Texas. Doughty will be coming up. Jamie Doughty will be the batter.
Got a little speed at first. Trent. Cliff Gustafson is the kind of coach that'll make something happen with those fleet people. He had a nice confrontation coming here because Wine throws as well as anybody. He had a play against Stanford. It was just hard to describe. It was that special when he had a short pass ball and threw a runner out.
Called strike. I tell you, Canwisher has a way of getting himself in some trouble, but he never stops battling. Way out in front. Wine lost the ball. Throw to second is on in time. Robbie Wine could not find it. The ball got behind him. I want to go down to Jim Price. Jim, this has happened to a lot of catchers. He simply couldn't find it.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, it's the most helpless feeling in the world to have something like that happen, and it's happened to every catcher that has played in the that is caught. Now you watch it right here. It bounces up. He gets it. He blocks it. But then he moves in front of the ball and it's behind him. He can't find it. And I tell you, I've done that in front of 50,000 people. And I tell you, it's a lonely feeling.
Jimmy, what's interesting, though, he's throwing with his feet square instead of bringing that left foot in front. He still almost gets it done. This guy's got a cannon.
He's got a cannon. I'll tell you, he's got the nicest hands for a catcher I've seen.
Hits the ball into right center field. It falls for a base hit. Here comes the runner around third, heading for home. Trent will score. It's all over. Texas wins it. Game-winning RBI to Jamie Doughty. The Longhorns move on in the College World Series.
The guy that Cliff Gustafson recruited out of Seminole Junior College. He thought he was going to be a great hitter for him. It didn't work out early. Boy, I tell you, does that tell the story right there? Doughty comes through with a tweener, and Texas advances.
Fine ball game, gentlemen.
An excellent ball game tonight in Omaha. The Longhorns win it. Doughty gets the game-winning hit in 11. Is he happy? He should be. Great ball game. Goes 11 innings. It's the second 11-inning game we have had, and it has the same final score as the earlier one. The Longhorns win it, 6-5 over Oklahoma State in 11 innings. We will be back here in Omaha, Nebraska. Jamie Doughty gets the game-winning hit with one out in the bottom half of the 11th inning, driving in Mike Trent with the winning run. And so Jamie is going to be our Vitalis MVP. The final totals, 5-11-1 for Oklahoma State. Texas, 6-9-4. Great ball game, Herb. Everything you could ask.
It really was. Mike Trent got it going, drew that base on balls, moved up on that short wild pitch, and then Doughty...